done that. It would have been typical Duke losing the last five football games. But he's done a great job there, and I think it'll be an interesting game.
You know, Duke trying to put together a winning season as well, because they're just 6-6 and 94 the last season in which they went to a bowl, finished with a winning record. Have to win this game to have a winning record. Cincinnati, after Butch Jones leaving, now trying to finish its season on a high note, just about set to go in the Belk Bowl. The Blue Devils of Duke taking on Cincinnati. Ready to take you out there right now.
You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
The party is in full swing in Charlotte at the Belk Bowl. Big East co-champion Cincinnati stands in the way of Duke's first bowl win in over half a century. Moments ago, Janine Edwards was in the Blue Devil locker room.
There's something pretty special happening right now here in this locker room. These players are experiencing something they have never done before. They're getting ready to take the field for a postseason game. They tell me they are hyped and they know what's at stake today. Since Duke's last bowl in 1995, they've had 17 straight losing seasons and 4 years with no wins. After implementing his vision and a lot of hard work,
you were chosen for a reason, on and off the field. You got a statement to make. You've got a statement to make. Walt, we chose you for a reason. Let the reason be seen. Lead the way, seniors. Duke football? Hell yes, it's Duke football. Let's go get this done.
David Cutcliffe has him fired up, and here come the Blue Devils. Welcome to the 2012 Belk Bowl. A bowl win for Duke would be monumental, but it won't come easy against the Cincinnati team looking for yet another 10-win season. Good evening, everybody. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham, it's great to have you with us. This is such a special moment for the Duke Blue Devils. When they're in a bowl game, you often hear, which one of these teams really wants to be here? Well, tonight, the answer is both of them, even though it's for different reasons.
And for Duke, it's obvious. I mean, I'm ready to go out and play for Duke right now after listening to Coach Cutcliffe. It's obvious why this is a big deal for Duke. A little more complicated, though, for Cincinnati. Remember, they lost their head coach when Butch Jones left to go to Tennessee. But Steve Stripling, who will go to Tennessee after this game, stayed behind as the interim head coach, and he challenged his team by saying, be elite. They can win, as you mentioned, their 10th game. The other teams that have won 10 games in the last 5 years, like Cincinnati will have done five of the last six, Oklahoma, Oregon, Alabama, and Virginia Tech. That's pretty elite. And Cincinnati, to a man, they're ready for this game.
Yeah, it's pretty good company. Duke's formula for success has been rather simple this year. Throw it, get it back, and throw it again. And they've been pretty good at it.
Well, let's not forget Cutcliffe's background, right? He coached Peyton Manning and Eli Manning in college. And he's developed a pretty good quarterback here at Duke, and Sean Renfrey, the senior from Arizona who had been recruited by Cutcliffe when he was an assistant for the second time at Tennessee, decided to come across country and has had a tremendous career. And a lot of that is because Cutcliffe has gone out and got some pretty good receivers as well. A guy who now is the ACC's all-time leading receiver, Connor Vernon, comes into his last game at Duke trying to impress NFL scouts, and that doesn't happen very often for Duke.
Cincinnati won a share of the Big East title because of a late-season gamble, and a big one. They changed quarterbacks.
Much of the go was throwing the ball to the other team a little too much, and they went with Brendan Kay in the second half against Syracuse. He brought the team back, and down the stretch, he led them to three of the last four ball games were wins, so that they got in as a co-Big East champion. Kay, a good runner, not quite as good as Lego, but he throws a good deep ball, and that will be key against Duke, who's been a little suspect in their secondary in the back half of the season.
That's Steve Stripling, the interim head coach. This will be his final appearance on the Cincinnati sideline. He'll be off to join Butch Jones at Tennessee. Let's check in with Janine Edwards on the sideline.
Well, Mike, one of the challenges for Cincinnati has been preparing for this bowl with only half a coaching staff. Instead of the normal 10 coaches, they're operating with only five. And one of the things they've had to deal with for this game is that several of the guys have to be up in the box. So they have three coaches and one grad assistant on the field for tonight's game. They've gone through dry runs with communications, but they are without one offensive and one defensive signaler. So they've recruited students. They've even recruited the office secretary's husband to help with play charting. So it's been sort of a piece together coaching staff tonight for Cincinnati. And TJ Wiest, who's up in the box with the wide receivers, and he is the offensive coordinator tonight, he told me communication and subbing will be the two biggest things that they're going to have to refine tonight, guys.
And Janine, except for Stripling, the other assistant coaches who are here are not assured of jobs. And this is a huge issue for them.
But I give them a lot of credit. Remember, this Cincinnati program went through a coaching change just 3 years ago when Brian Kelly left, and that was not under perfect circumstances. I think the way Butch Jones left and left Stripling behind and some of these coaches, they're doing this for the right reason. They're doing it for this team.
Pat O'Donnell will kick it away. Almost half of his kicks have been touchbacks. The return out across the 20 for Crowder, the outstanding wide receiver, and Duke will start from there. Sean Renfrey completing two-thirds of his passes. He's nearing the 3,000-yard mark, 18 touchdowns, and only 8 interceptions. He's won a slew of awards, including the Pop Warner Award, a Pop Warner alumnus who's been outstanding on the field, in the classroom, and in his community. Juwan Thompson will start at running back. Duke does not run the ball very much. And Renfrey to throw on first down. Pump and go. Caught by Thompson, runs the wheel route out of the backfield at the 42-yard line. A gain of 21 on the first play, Ed Cunningham.
Nice job by Renfrey. Great protection by this offensive line. And Cincinnati, in their secondary, this has been a solid defense. But their problem has been, for Cincinnati, if they have not gotten the pass rush, you can throw some balls on them. They're 72nd in the country in pass defense, so fits what Duke likes to do on offense.
A new tailback, Snead, number 9. Duke will rotate three guys. Snead will carry. Duke, as far as the running game, only 104th in the country, and Cincinnati is 27th stopping the run. So it's weakness against strength in the Cincinnati defense. As far as scoring, they're 12th in the country. They've done a sensational job where it matters most, and that's on the scoreboard.
And you look at what they lost from last year. Two defensive linemen went to the NFL. Steve Stripling, who's acting as the defensive coordinator, they did a fantastic job with the D-line this season.
Snead trying to get to the outside across midfield into Cincinnati territory to the 44 and a first down. The tackle finally made by Cameron Beard, one of the defensive linemen who chased the play down. But if Duke gets anything out of the run game, it's a bonus.
One of the things when you watch Duke on offense and you start to realize this is not the Duke of 3 or 4 years ago, is their offensive line's getting better every time you watch them. They're athletic, they stay on blocks, they may not push guys off the ball, they're not as physical as some teams, but this is a good group up front.
Renfrey wants a screen, but there's nobody there and he throws it away. We're trying to set it up for David Reeves, who's one of the tight ends, but Cincinnati diagnosed that very well.
Well, Steve Stripling again, who's calling the defense today with John Jancic, who has moved on with Butch Jones to Tennessee, decided that time to bring pressure on first down, knowing that Cutcliffe and Duke throws as much as they do. That's a good down, first and 10, if you're playing a team like Duke, to bring pressure. And that was a good call that time by Stripling and his pared down defensive staff.
Thompson back in at running back. He wears number 23 and he gets it on the draw. Big haul for Thompson. He'll pick up 8. The middle linebacker and the leading tackler on this team, Greg Blair, was in there on that stop. He's the all Big East inside linebacker.
And watch the block by Lakin Tomlinson. He's going one-on-one that time with Cameron Beard, and as Beard goes outside, Again, it's not a powerful block, but he's got the athleticism and the technique. He doesn't fall forward. He maintains his block and lets the defender not only run himself out of the play, but also pushes him a bit. That's just nice athletic offensive line play.
Big early down here, third and two. They may be in four down territory. They won't need it as the leading receiver all time in ACC history, Connor Vernon, picks up his first catch on a post, and it's a gain of 20.
And this is exactly what Sean Renfrey said, the types of throws that they had to hit. When they're open underneath, you have to hit what he called the easy throws against Cincinnati. That time, Devin Drain, the cornerback, played so far off. All they had to do, Duke, was sit Vernon inside, and that was an easy throw and catch. But Renfrey said, those are the key ones. You've got to convert those. Nice throw.
274 catches all time. Two backs in the backfield. Cincinnati shows blitz. Snead, another big hole. Snead inside the five.
Well, and another fantastic block by the right guard, Lakin Tomlinson. He's a guy that's the most physical player up front for Duke, and that time he pushed Beard all the way across the play and opened up a huge hole. This Duke offensive line, it's a pretty impressive group.
And I know it takes a lot to impress you up front, and you've been impressed ever since you started reading about it. Quarterback keeper Renfrey, touchdown. How's that for an opening drive? They obviously didn't come to this bowl game just to show up.
No. I think they may have caught Cincinnati a little off guard with that inside run game.
I do too. Ross Martin described by David Cutcliffe as the most talented kicker he has ever had is on for the point after. And it was tipped. Can they run it in? Yes! Holy cow! Ross Martin, if he can't kick it, he'll run it in.
Well, the ball was blocked behind the line of scrimmage. So therefore, the offensive team can pick it up and score. So you mentioned that this young man is the most talented kicker he's ever had. He also might be the smartest.
The passion, the pride, the perseverance, the commitment to get cash benefits directly to you when you can really use the money to help pay bills. Like when you're hurt.
Thanks. I needed that.
Aflac, an official partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Would anyone like a little more cheese and crackers?
Or how about a little more room on the couch,
But my wife likes to record her home makeover shows the same time my son records his shows about wizards, so.
We should go.
No, stay. It's not like I can watch TV anyway. Let's get down on this cheese. Rob, you look like a Brie man if I've ever seen one.
Upgrade to DirecTV and record 5 shows at once. Call 1-800-DIRECTV.
I love the holidays.
And with my Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards credit card, I love them even more.
I earn 1% cash back everywhere, every time.
2% on groceries.
3% on gas, automatically.
No hoops to jump through.
That's 1% back on...
2% on pumpkin pie.
And apple.
3% back on 4 trips to the airport.
It's as easy as 1, 2, 3.
The Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards card. Apply online or at a Bank of America near you.
That's going to be a slugfest.
The championship game doesn't get more compelling than Notre Dame and Alabama.
It'll be some scene down in South Florida.
Welcome to the Belk Bowl. 125 years ago, my grandfather opened his first department store right here in North Carolina with a vision. Today, we call it modern Southern style. But it's more than just shopping. It's a way of life, where family is first and friends are family. And commitment to community matters most. Welcome to the Belk Bowl. Make yourself at home and enjoy the game.
The celebration may be over for Duke as far as that extra point is concerned. It looks like it's going to be overturned by instant replay, and here's why, Ed.
Well, watch the knee right at the end here by Martin. Good hustle there to finish the play, and the ball had not crossed the goal line. Now, they're saying indisputable video evidence. I think you can infer the ball didn't cross the line. I'm not so convinced from either of these two replays you can say that it did not. I don't think it did, but I'm not so sure that this should have been overturned.
Well, I think you used the right word, infer.
Yeah.
I think you have to do that because it is not indisputable.
Which you're not supposed to do, but that give Aaron Chenault a really good tip of the cap for Cincinnati for not finishing that play. But remember, when the ball never crosses the line of scrimmage in a kick situation and goes backwards, the offense can advance it. So Chenault had very good heads-up defense for Cincinnati to finish off that play.
Adam Dempsey gets credit for the block, so it's 6-0 Blue Devils. And Ralph David Abernathy IV takes the kick in the end zone, and they will start from the 25-yard line. This is Brendan Kay, who has started the last four ball games, took over for Munchie Lego, and has really stabilized the offense. He may not make the spectacular plays that Lego made, but he will not make the big mistakes that Lego made, and that's why Butch Jones made the decision after the eighth game. That's really rolling the dice.
And for Tommy Tuberville, the coach who was hired away from Texas Tech to take over for Butch Jones, good news that Kay, a senior, was granted a sixth year of eligibility. So this is actually not his last game as a Bearcat.
Empty backfield, and Kay wants to throw on first down. Abernathy will pick up about three. Ross Cockrell made the tackle.
And T.J. Wiest, who is calling the plays today. Mike Bajakian, the offensive coordinator, has gone on to Tennessee, but Wiest had told us that he wants to get Abernathy involved as much as he possibly can.
He is so quick. The other guy they want to get involved has the ball right now. George Wynn, who was the backup a year ago to the outstanding Isaiah Pede. They really didn't know what they had, only gained a couple of hundred yards in reserve. As it turns out, he put up almost identical numbers to Isaiah Pede, who was the Big East Offensive Player of the Year.
And Wynn really took advantage last year in the Liberty Bowl. He was always seen as kind of the big power back to Pede's speed, elusive back. But he had a 69-yard touchdown run in that game. The coach thought, well, wait a minute, he might have a gear we don't know about. And sure enough, came into camp in great condition and has had a spectacular senior season.
What do they do on third and three? Duke trying to apply pressure. Wynn on the screen. And he's going to be stopped short. The Duke defense, which has given up 49 and a half points a game in its last four, comes out and gives the offense the ball back after a three and out.
Well defended by Duke. They were in a straight zone coverage. They don't blitz a lot, and that's a down where you typically may bring a blitz, but because they're in that zone defense, everybody reacted well to the screen. It took a little longer, I think, than Cincinnati wanted to get the ball over to Wynn, but that was a nice Wynn for Duke defensively.
Pat O'Donnell, who averages 42 yards a kick, punting to Connor Vernon. Just got it out of there, end over end. And he'll lose some yards as the ball goes out of bounds. It's marked up near the 40. Excellent field position for Duke when we come back after a punt of 25.
At Belk, we're committed to supporting Southern communities and families. But together, we can do even more. There are cures to find and awareness to raise. Young minds to inspire in the classroom. Homes to build for neighbors in need. And hearts to mend. Together. So join us. At Belk, modern Southern style isn't just about fashion. It's a way of life and about giving back. To learn more, go to belk.com.
Why do I like this new Buick Verano? It lets me audible.
OnStar, how can I help you?
Orange barrel, reroute.
Sending new route now.
My friend. Call Papa Bear. Hut, hut.
Hey, Peyton, just fired up the grill.
Tune XM60 Outlaw. If you don't know the innovative Verano, then you don't know Buick.
Don't wait for the new year to experience Buick. Lease this innovative Buick Verano with 2 years of scheduled maintenance for around $199 per month.
Bad boys, get ready for a big change in tires. Introducing Tread Smart at pepboys.com. Shop, schedule, and save online anytime. Choose from Pep Boys' huge selection of national tire brands. Buy online, pick a time, and we'll install your tires at Pep Boys 7 days a week. Tread Smart. Information to installation in a click. Pretty smart, huh? Tread Smart at pepboys.com. Take it for a spin.
This is the world of today's PC. A dark age where imagination has been banished and shapeless, gray designs have remained unchanged for decades. But now, we have the freedom to choose a different kind of personal computer. One with a sleek, razor-thin design and stunning performance. The PC reimagined by Vizio.
In college football, the Belk Bowl is brought to you by Belk, modern Southern style, ProjectLuna.com, and the experienced Buick Lease. It's a new lease on luxury.
Belk's flagship store is here in Charlotte, and the players had a unique opportunity to shop for their own bowl gifts. Really cool. Belk thought of everything, even the special big and tall section.
I was going to say, that's honestly, of bowl gifts, I would rank that up there because you get something and, you know, you go into a place like that. But I was going to say, I hope the big and tall department made some extra orders before those guys came in.
Except for the wide receivers and defensive backs, you bet. Duncan gets his first carry as a tailback, and we'll check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike, Duke wide receiver Desmond Scott teaches school in his spare time to kindergartners through fourth graders near Durham. He told me he feels he has a calling to teach. He'd like to get into that as a profession. He thinks we need more positive role models for kids, and I'll tell you what he did with his Belk Bowl gift card in a second.
That's a great story, too, Janine. Duncan goes in motion. Renfrey flanker screen. Complete to Crowder. Crowder with running room, and it's another first down for the Blue Devils as we go back to Janine.
Well, as you said, Mike, they got a $500 Belk Bowl gift card, and they could shop for their own gifts. And rather than picking out something for himself or his family, Desmond Scott bought clothes and toys for underprivileged kids in Durham. I'd say that is a positive role model.
Way to go, Desmond. Hats off to you. First down, Blue Devils. Duncan trying to get outside, shakes a tackle, power running. This kid is 5'10", 200 pounds, and he was just running over people.
This is just not the team that you saw on film all season long. This is the down around sweep of the Green Bay Packers.
Yes,
we've all
exactly.
seen the film. If you get a seal here,
that's
you get a seal there, and a lane there. This is not what Cincinnati expected to see from Duke. Good hard running there at the end.
They got two seals, and then Paul Horning finished it off. Renfrey again. Good block. Should be a touchdown. Dropped. Off the fingertips of Jawan Thompson, who was open down the sideline, and Renfrey laid it right there.
And that was the exact play call they ran on the first play of the game.
To the other
Kurt
side.
Roper, the offensive coordinator, went right back to it, and unfortunately for Thompson, just didn't quite finish it. That's a tough catch for a running back. There is no doubt about it, but that was a pretty good throw by Renfrey.
Boy, was it ever. Draw play, not this time, although Duncan turns what could have been a yard loss into about a 3-yard gain before Malik Bomar, the second leading tackler on this team, brings him down. Bomar wears number 4 for the Bearcats.
Good hard running by Duncan. That looked like it was going to be about a 2-yard loss. And coming into this game, this was not a team that rushed the ball a ton. And this just doesn't look like the same group.
104th in the country out of 120 schools. 3rd and 7. 4-man rush. Pass underneath is going to be about 1.5 yards shy of a first down as they threw it to Blakeney.
I think you go for it here.
K Cameron Cheatham made the tackle.
Yeah, there's no reason to kick a field goal. You're in your bowl game. You essentially are almost home field advantage here. And the way they've been running it, I wouldn't mess around. They're going fast. I think they probably run this out of this formation somewhere between the tackles. And they got a wildcat.
About a yard and a half, and the wildcat is Brandon Kinnett, who is a really good runner.
Before the snap, timeout, Cincinnati. Their first time out of
there. Yeah, they saw Kinnett in there, and I don't think that they were quite ready. Remember, Janine mentioned the communication issues. When you make a change like that, that is tough for Cincinnati to get that change made.
The Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, Oregon, Kansas State, January 3rd on ESPN.
Join us at ProjectLuna.com.
Break the ice with breath-freshening, cooling crystals, icebreakers.
I may have retired from the game, but not from being big. Good thing one car gives me full-size luxury and 36 miles per gallon, which is nice because I've got shoes that are bigger than most hybrids. And more stylish, too. If you don't know the luxurious yet fuel-efficient LaCrosse, you don't know Buick.
Don't wait for the new year to experience Buick. Lease this EPA-estimated 36 highway MPG LaCrosse with 2 years of scheduled maintenance for around $299.
Power your escape with a car as alive as you are. Introducing Instinctive All-Wheel Drive from Jaguar.
For great offers, visit your Detroit Jaguar retailer today.
Where can you get a Sealy Posturepedic Queen Pillow Top mattress with pressure-relieving memory foam for a door-busting $187? Only at Bedding Expert's New Year's Sale. Get a Queen Gel-Infused Memory Foam mattress for only $249. Twin Firm mattresses start at just $79. Tempur-Pedic starts at $699. And to buy now and pay no interest for 5 years, it's only at
the Bedding Expert's, where dreams come true.
Sale ends Tuesday, New Year's Day.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Welcome back to Charlotte, North Carolina for the Belk Bowl, where Duke is leading Cincinnati 6-0, and the Blue Devils driving again. The catch on third down goes to Brandon Kinnett, number 18, not Blake the 17. Kinnett has been used in a variety of ways. Running the ball, catching the ball, throwing the ball, wide receiver, tight end. And now they'll come out in a tight formation, and they've got Renfrey back at quarterback. And Renfrey wants to throw for it, and does. And they've got a first down to Kinnett, who's down to the 11-yard line. So Kinnett has made two catches in this game. He is a short yardage specialist when they go to the Wildcat. He scored 7 touchdowns off that formation.
And instead of coming out in the Wildcat that they showed before the timeout, Duke decides to put Kinnett in the backfield. I love how they sprinted out and they kind of hid Renfrey as the quarterback, and then Kinnett slips out and it's an easy, great play action set up because Duke's been able to run the ball early.
Whistles will stop this play. Could have been early motion on the Blue Devils.
And that's a big unforced error for Duke here. That's a penalty.
Prior to the snap, false start, 68 offense. 5-yard penalty, still first down.
That's our offensive line leader, Brian Moore. You really like him, don't you?
This offensive line, and apparently some of the guys that they're redshirting, they've really done a nice job here at Duke in recruiting offensive linemen. It's the biggest growth, I think, in the program that I've seen over the last couple of years, is their ability to develop offensive linemen. You just didn't see that here at Duke very often.
Blakeney is the motion man. Draw play to Thompson. Thompson gets a kiss at the line of scrimmage. And it was the middle linebacker, Greg Blair, who was pleading with his defensive teammates during that last timeout with a fiery speech.
And Blair, a guy who is petitioning. We already mentioned the sixth year of eligibility for the quarterback at Cincinnati, but Blair, a guy who may be playing his last game, but he lost most of 2011 with injury, and he's applied for a sixth year.
Fake to Duncan. Renfrey to the end zone. Some contact, no flag, incomplete. Good coverage by Drain against Connor Vernon.
Yeah, Drain was on him the whole way, and the crowd, the Duke crowd, maybe wanted interference, but that was an uncatchable ball. But excellent coverage. And now here you are, Duke, because of you go backwards 5 yards, you get nothing on first down, you get nothing on second down, incomplete, and now you're in a bad position. I think you've got to think something. You've got to give Renfrey something that puts the ball, you know, inside the 10, so you have a makeable first down, or obviously going for it if you're going to go for it on fourth.
Renfrey on the post, almost intercepted, and should have been. That pass was underthrown into the arms of Chris Williams. He couldn't hold it.
Williams did a wonderful job. He read this the whole way. You teach defensive backs, if you read it, run the route, and that is exactly what Chris Williams did. He knew that Desmond Scott, a converted running back, and that's key. Scott takes a few more steps to break into his route than a normal receiver. Scott changed positions earlier in the year, and that was a great read by Williams.
Martin will try from 33 yards out. He's 18 of 20 this year. He's had a brilliant freshman season. And Duke increases its lead to 9-0. The Blue Devils have had it twice. They have scored twice here against Cincinnati.
At the University of Cincinnati, we know all about the competitive spirit. We know how to rise above, push beyond, and pull ahead. It's all you see.
The Rose Bowl game on New Year's Day. Senior running back Bonte Ball leads Wisconsin against number 6 Stanford. The Rose Bowl game presented by Vizio. Our coverage starts at 4:30 New Year's Day on ESPN. Also live on the Watch ESPN app.
You know, a lot of people look at that game and say, oh, Stanford in a wash, Wisconsin lost 5 ball games this year. We had Wisconsin against Michigan State. I'd be awfully careful the way Monty Ball ran the back half of the season and the improvement of that Wisconsin offensive line just to sign that one up for the Cardinals.
Ask Nebraska how good Wisconsin is.
And they'll be motivated too. I know they lost their coach, but I think the way Barry Alvarez has handled that transition has been superb. And the captain's asking him to be the head coach. I think that group will be ready to play. Oh, and by the way, it is the Rose Bowl, so you've got that going too.
Abernathy will take a knee. It has been all Duke so far. They have scored on both possessions. Cincinnati went 3 and out the only time they had the ball in this game.
You don't want to say big important drive with 6:12 left in the first quarter, but let's say medium level concern if you're a Cincinnati fan and this does not turn into some type of positive offensive drive.
Brendan Kay will send 3 wide receivers to the near side. Wynn in the backfield with him, number 32. Kelsey, their leading receiver, the tight end in motion, now resets. And Kelsey will get it on the pass. And Kelsey is pasted by Jordan Bias.
And Bias needs to be taken off the field. Bias is punch drunk because he led with his helmet, and this was a missed call. This should, I believe, should have been a targeting call. But watch as 38 turns and drops his head. Yeah, that's a helmet to helmet, and you can see it is the defensive player Bias who comes out of this ill for the wear. That's unfortunate, and that's the thing that we're working so hard. It's so fast, it's so hard to call, but because he drops his head and leads with the crown of his helmet, that should have been a penalty. And let's hope the young man is okay.
Well, I hope so too. Yeah. And that was, you could hear the collision all the way up here.
Yeah, and bias just immediately after the hit. And it is so hard. It is so natural to drop your head when you're running full speed. It's not a malicious thing. It is literally nature. Get up off your couch, run full speed at the wall, and you're going to, because you have to protect your nose and your eyes and your face. It's a natural thing to do. It's something we have to work incredibly hard to try to get guys to play with their heads up, but that's the problem.
In most places, you're taught to do that.
Oh, it's
Those years of do this. Now it's, hey, don't do that.
Yeah. Well, and there is the adage of see what you hit, and you're a better player when you're on your feet. You're a better player when your face mask is up in every regard. So it's just something we all have to work on. Let's hope for Bias that he's okay.
And Duke is already thin in the secondary.
Yeah, that's a good point.
This is up for grabs and knocked away. The best defensive back on the field for Duke is Cockrell. It was intended for Tompkins, and Cockrell was there stride for stride. Now, maybe if Kay got it out there a little further, his guy's got a chance.
I don't know. Cockrell was inside the shoes of the receiver. That's called a pickpocket. When a corner is running with a guy, you want to put that hand right down where he'd carry his wallet, like you're going to pick his pocket, wait for the time. You cannot play that any better. I'm not sure any ball could have been completed, and I'm not sure Cockrell would have interfered in any case. Good body control, great position.
Okay, here comes pressure. Throws underneath, caught by Kelsey, and then knocked back toward the line of scrimmage. What a defense by the Blue Devils.
Unbelievable that 38 Jordan Bias is still in the game, and he is the guy who once again leads with his helmet on this hit. I am absolutely shocked that Bias was in this game, and it's the exact same before, and you see him go down in a pile. I'm blown away that Bias was in the ball game after two plays ago having this exact same thing happen, and he came up punch drunk from that hit. I'm shocked.
Kelsey may think it's personal. It's happened to him twice. Blocked. Touchdown. The Duke Blue Devils get Tony Foster in the end zone with the recovery. Holy cow. Foster blocks it and then gets it. Nothing punch drunk about that one. What a stunning turn of events.
Well, on the last punt, Tony Foster was a half a step away from a lock. So what do? You call the same rush, and this time tell him get that half step this time.
That's
and see
right.
What happens.
Get there faster.
And he did.
Martin for the point after. And it's 16-0 Duke. If you saw this coming, raise your hand.
Right on the outside there, Foster exactly where he was lined up before. A strong rush in the middle, so the big bodies that are the personal protectors for the punter can't fan out because there was four bodies coming in the middle, and Foster comes free again.
One of the problems with a smaller coaching staff is that on most teams, you share duties on special teams. There aren't enough guys to share stuff.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because the last time Cincinnati punted, if you're Cincinnati, you say, hey, 31 ran free from that side. What do we have to do? Make sure we fan out. Now you don't have as much communication.
Exactly.
You don't have a special teams guy to say, hey, we've got to fix that protection next time we go out. Duke knows it. They call the same thing. And Duke would have called the same thing anyway, because if you don't fix it, hey, we're going to come after it. So good job by Duke, but I think you're right.
And you can bet the next time Cincinnati punts, Foster's going to be coming again, because if you haven't fixed it, you're going to go right back to the well again.
Now, that's good coaching. And tough on Cincinnati, because when you are shorthanded like they are, those are the things that get exposed.
And you can see by the look on their face, they're just stunned on this sideline.
Well, the part that's stunning to me is the physical run game Duke has brought to this game. You just didn't expect that.
Ralph David Abernathy the fourth will bring it out. Flying across the 20, belted down at the 24,
we check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, guys, just as you were discussing about the lack of coaches for Cincinnati, I mean, they have got students and they've got managers out here trying to coach up these players. The players are trying to coach each other. The defense especially, they're telling themselves to settle down, guys. We've got a tackle. Duke's getting a little too comfortable back there. And then Steve Stripling came over at one point and said, guys, you've got to stay positive. We will wear them down. But the managers are having to relay comments from the coaches up in the box. I mean, it's obvious that they're having a few issues right now with the lack of staff.
Well, it happens every time this time of year where you see bowl teams where they're not sure their coach is, and this is that personified.
Win, gang tackled. C.J. France, number 54, led the charge. And you can tell, I mean, this Duke defense, these guys are not the most athletic players you're ever going to see in college football, but you know how hard they have studied during the interim between their last game and this bowl game. They are in the right place at the right time.
To explain how important a bowl game is, it's the same as having another spring practice. It's 15 or more practices to get ready for a bowl game, so it's almost like you go through an entire spring drills before the game.
Kay on the keeper, shakes a tackler, and up to the 46. 20 yards on the run, and this kid can not only throw the ball very well, as Ed told you already, he can run maybe not as spectacularly as Munchie Lego, but he can get it done.
And for Duke, it was such a tough stretch down those last four ball games. But if you look at that schedule, Clemson, Florida State, Georgia Tech, Miami, their schedule was just a little weighted towards the backside. Almost unfair, frankly.
Flanker screen, Tompkins only got back to the line of scrimmage. That said, 49.5 points a game. It's tough to defend that.
Well, you're in the Coastal Division, and you have to play Atlantic Division opponents. Okay, we're going to give you Florida State and Clemson, and you're going to have to play them back-to-back. That's a little unfair for Duke. And David Cutcliffe is very clear. We're not ready to play every game against teams like Florida State and Clemson. And frankly, they got beat up a bit. By the time they get to Miami, they just didn't have much left in the tank.
It's so hard to build depth, for one thing. Wynn on the draw, breaks a tackle, first down Wynn. He is so powerful, down to the 30-yard line.
And that run and the run by Brendan Kay, I think, may start to energize this Cincinnati team a minute ago.
Absolutely.
A moment ago, Kay took off and lowered his shoulder and picked up the first down. And then Wynn does what he's been doing all year, which is, if you're going to try to arm tackle me, it's just not going to happen.
The one downside for the Blue Devil defense all year long, the ability to tackle in space. Wynn again. Going to get a huge dose of 32. That's good pursuit that time.
And this is the type of run Janine was saying about Coach Stripling, saying we're going to wear them down. This is the type of run that if you're Cincinnati, you've just got to go back to the well. It's just a zone blocking outside stretch. You make the defense run. You only pick up about 3 yards, but that's going to become four. It's going to become five. It's going to become eight by the end of the game.
Second in the conference this year is Wynn, averaging over 100 yards a ball game. Second, call it seven. Kay wants a screen. And is it intercepted? No signal yet. It is. Picked off by Walt Canty. They tried to throw a screen and overthrew it.
Well, this is the same screen that Cincinnati had a problem with before, but I'm not so sure that Canty makes this catch. That's enough. So this will be third and seven.
It will.
Yeah, so now Cincinnati is going to get this ball back.
The official on that side came in. He was obviously unsure whether it was caught or not. Was looking at another official. Finally, he said, Duke ball. But they're going to turn this over.
Well, and you talk to any official around college football, these guys love reviews, because they just want to get the call right.
Sure.
You know, we were talking to the officials before the ball game, and they said, you know, when they overturn a call that was a touchdown that cost the team the game, later in the week, all they talked about was that they scored the touchdown to win. They don't talk about they overturned our call that he was out of bounds. That's
right.
That's what officials want. They just want to get these right, and this will be overturned and be Cincinnati ball. And You know, that's the hard part, though, for Cincinnati. You feel like, oh, you know, kind of the wind leaves your sails a little bit. You got the good offense going, and now you thought they had the INT. Now you got to get third and seven and get it back.
Was not a good throw by Brendan Kay, whose calling card has been making the good throws and not making the mistakes. That could have been awful for them.
But I think T.J. Wiest, who's the interim offensive coordinator for Cincinnati, needs to take that play out of there. That's twice they've almost
After
blown.
Review, the ball touched the ground before the receiver gained possession. Therefore, it's an incomplete pass. It'll be third down at the 28-yard line.
And from this spot, it's probably four down territory yep. if you're the Bearcat offense. Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, he says, we're getting there, but it takes time to build a defense. It takes time to build a reputation where kids want to come and play defense.
And they've improved the football experience with the facilities, the training facilities, everything's improved at Duke. So
Absolutely.
When guys come in, it's okay, this is big time football. And they'll start to do it. This is a good step.
And Jim Knowles is a guy who likes to blitz, likes to play all out on defense, but he can't do it with the guys he has.
Well, and their secondary.
He doesn't want to put them in lousy positions.
And their secondary lost six guys to injuries this year. We already mentioned it looks like they may have lost another one in Bias today. And so this is a group that's been thin to begin with.
And Janine tells us that Jordan Bias, who has had two helmet-to-helmet collisions with Travis Kelce so far in this game, is out until at least a half, and they'll evaluate him at that point. But he came up a little loopy after a couple of tackles.
Yeah, I always just get worried. When you see a guy who's punch drunk on the field, I think we might want to talk about a standard rule where someone has to sit for a number of plays before they come back in. We've seen that a couple of times this year.
Third and seven for Kay. Abernathy is his running back, number one. Duke showing man-to-man coverage and showing blitz, and here they come. Kay unloads, underthrown. Great coverage by Ross Cockrell.
And Cockrell, a guy who, and I do believe, if you're Cincinnati, you got to seriously consider going for it. It doesn't look like they're going to. I think if you get something there, but Cockrell, a guy, boy, it's just nice coverage. He's one-on-one, no wasted steps, had great inside position. This is a guy who really struggled his freshman year out there on the island, and he's done nothing but work his way into a really solid college cornerback.
Tony Miliano's had a good year.
And here's some confusion. Here's some confusion on the special teams again, just getting in the right personnel. Not surprising, such a tough deal when you have a coaching change.
And Cincinnati called time rather than be penalized by 5 yards. Again, in case you're unfamiliar with Cincinnati's situation, there are only four coaches left from Butch Jones' staff after he went to Tennessee. So they're splitting up as many duties as they possibly can, and sometimes special teams gets left in the dust.
And with Tommy Tuberville coming in as the coach, which was a great hire by Cincinnati, by the way, took everybody by surprise, including me. I was in SportsCenter saying, wow, what a great hire, but I'm a little confused by it. But Tommy Tuberville decided to let these coaches finish, didn't want to coach the bowl game. He's been out recruiting. But when you get hired like Butch Jones did on December 7th, you're in the prime recruiting window before the holidays. And so that's the biggest issue to me, is all of those coaches that you're going to take have to go. And you give Stripling and the guys, especially Steve Stripling, who stayed behind, credit. But it is really tough on the players and kind of what's new in college football.
Miliano will try from 45 to get Cincinnati on the board. Plenty of distance and down the middle. Cincinnati puts up three. They're down 13.
Imagine a place where spirit lives, in stadiums and libraries, where minds are expanded, pushed, pulled, and tested amidst old forests and new buildings, where you learn, discover, serve, where you take center stage on campus, in the world, in your life. Imagine a place of outrageous ambitions. Imagine Duke.
the DirecTV mobile studio. Stop by Charlotte and Bank of America Stadium on the drive to the BCS Championship. New Cincinnati coach Tommy Tuberville stepped onto the bus to talk to College Football Live yesterday.
miles on the odometer of that bus. Yeah, that thing's been around college football a few times.
16-3, if you're just joining us. Duke has stunned the Bearcats of Cincinnati early here in the Belk Bowl in Charlotte.
And I think the momentum from that drive for Cincinnati got killed when they thought Canty make the interception for Duke. It gets overturned, and it looked like what was a great drive that started with Brendan Kay and a nice physical run kind of got stuck in the mud after they got the ball back. It took the officials a minute to get the ball set, and it almost felt like it was a turnover, I think, for Cincinnati.
Crowder and Karan Wune are deep. And Crowder will let it hit. They'll take it to 25. Well, we've got five games across ESPN and ESPN2 highlighting Saturday's Capital One Bowl Week action. The Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl kicks it off. Then the New Era Pinstripe Bowl at 4 on ESPN2. The Kraft Fight Hunger Bowl. The Valero Alamo Bowl at 6:45 on ESPN. And we wrap it up at 10:15. To the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl. Capital One Bowl Week Saturday on ESPN. ESPN2 also live on Watch ESPN.
If you have not seen Michigan State play defense this year, tune in. That, again, it's a team you look at, no one really thought much about, but they played solid defense all year, and I think TCU is going to have their hands full.
Renfrey, they get it out in a hurry to Scott. And Desmond Scott will pick up 4 or 5. That's really an extension of the running game, being able to put Scott, the former running back, out there in a flanker spot.
Of course, Scott had to move when Blair Holiday, who was a receiver coming into the season, was in a horrific jet skiing accident and wasn't able to play this season. Obviously, his career actually may be over, but they had to take Scott from running back to put a receiver. Nice change.
Now back to the other side, Vernon. Another flanker screen with the other wide receivers out in front throwing blocks. Now pick up about 10, and Duncan out of the backfield threw a good block to spring the ACC's all-time leading receiver and yardage receiver as well.
And this is, as Duke now going fast, is like a run for them. They get the ball out on the edge on what is called a tunnel screen as the receiver runs down a tunnel.
Renfrey. Crowder couldn't hold it. Good defense by Cameron Cheatham right there with him, knocked it away.
Well, the thing that Cheatham did that was so nice during that play is he was being hand-checked by Crowder. Watch the left arm of Crowder. He was trying to get him pushed away from him, but Cheatham just fought through, and Cheatham barely. Watch as I think he gets the left arm. You can see the little push-off there by Crowder. Both players hand-checking, so they're not going to call that. But Cheatham continued to play. Good finish.
Crowder over 1,000 yards this year. Vernon shakes a tackle within about 2 yards of the sticks at midfield. Connor Vernon out of Miami could be the first Duke draft choice. Get this, the first one since 2004.
No, he will be the first draft choice. With those ball skills and that athleticism, and I've been told he'll run a sub 4.5 40 when he gets to the combine. That's what they're expecting. He's been training hard. He graduates, right? He's already graduated, so he gets to train for that combine. Don't be surprised if this guy starts moving up the big boards of the guys at ESPN.
Duncan has the first down to the Cincinnati 49-yard line. I think the ground game for Duke has been the most impressive thing. You know they can throw.
And you know what's going to start happening. Cincinnati's going to start having to bring those safeties down around the line of scrimmage, because all of a sudden Duke looks like Wisconsin with their downhill running game. And you know that the old quarterback coach Cutcliffe is going to dial up a few throws over the top.
10 carries for 60 yards so far for the Blue Devils. Snead will try to add to it, and will. Snead has another first down, picks up 12. At 72 yards rushing, in the first quarter. They only average 119 a game.
And there are gigantic holes so far. I just don't think Cincinnati had any clue that they were going to see this much run. And, you know, frankly, I'm not so sure Duke knew they were going to call it, but if you're going to get this much success, you might as well keep dialing it up.
It's all Blue Devils here at the Belk Bowl in Charlotte against the Bearcats of Cincinnati.
I may have retired from the game, but not from being big. Good thing one car gives me full-size luxury and 36 miles per gallon, which is nice because I've got shoes that are bigger than most hybrids and more stylish, too. If you don't know the luxurious yet fuel-efficient LaCrosse, you don't know Buick.
Don't wait for the new year to experience Buick. Lease this EPA-estimated 36-highway MPG LaCrosse with 2 years of scheduled maintenance for around $299 per month.
He has inside jokes with complete strangers. Cuba imports cigars from him. Mosquitoes refuse to bite him, purely out of respect. He is the most interesting man in the world.
I don't always drink beer, but when I do, I prefer Dos Equis. Stay thirsty, my friends.
Mr. Parker? Sir, can I get you to sign off on the Johnson case?
We built this city.
Don't let food hang around. Clean it up with Orbit. Fabulous! For a good clean feeling.
Eat, drink, chew, Orbit.
This is bad. I'm bluffing. I am so bluffing. This is all my rent money.
I'm all in.
Well, it's in there now.
Sweating on the inside? Handle it on the outside with new Speed Stick Power.
Not bad for my first time.
Speed Stick. Don't sweat it. Handle it.
Let's give thanks for an idea. A grand idea called America. The idea that if you work hard, if you have a dream, if you work with your neighbors, you can do most anything. This led to other ideas, like liberty and rock and roll, to free markets, free enterprise, and free refills. It put a man on the moon and a phone in your pocket. Our country's gone through a lot over the centuries and a half, but this idea isn't fragile. When times get tough, it rallies us as one. Every day, more people believe in the American idea. And when they do, the dream comes true. We're grateful to be a part of it.
Let's give you some history. Duke met Alabama in the 1945 Sugar Bowl, and the Blue Devils won 29-26. Then they beat Arkansas 7-6 in the 1961 Cotton Bowl. No bowl games again until 1989. The Blue Devils fell to Texas Tech, Steve Spurrier's last game. And then the Hall of Fame Bowl, the last one in 1995, as they fell to Wisconsin 34-20. Tonight marks Duke's first bowl appearance since. And that last win, 1961, in the Cotton Bowl. They can win their first bowl game in 51 years tonight.
And it's not going to end 7-6.
No, it's not. Blakeney to about the 33. Well, if you're around in 1961, you didn't have to have a whole lot of money to buy a gallon of gas or a loaf of bread. A first class stamp was only 4 cents, and a gallon of milk, 49 cents.
And it's obvious that David Cutcliffe and his staff have changed the culture here. It was neat to see Duke fans were at their hotel gathering before bowl game.
Snead. Boy, he's got some quickness, doesn't he?
Yes.
Snead to the 26, another first down for the Blue Devils.
And that offensive line for Duke is just beating up the front wall of Cincinnati. And Connor Vernon just limped off. Not a good sign.
Grabbing that right knee, it looks like.
This is the only school, by the way, with three receivers over 60 catches for the season. They have been that good in the passing game. Fake to Snead. Renfrey throws to Scott. Tried to stay in bounds, knocked out at the 22. Here's Janine.
Well, Mike and Ed, you were just talking about David Cutcliffe and changing this program for Duke. One of the things you didn't hear in his pregame speech in the locker room was when he first came here and took this job in 2008, he said he'd walk through the airport or he'd be in town and he'd be wearing his Duke football jacket. And he said people would come up to him and say, Duke? Football? Duke has a football team? He said, we are changing that.
Well, tonight would be another big step in the process, wouldn't it? Renfrey on second down. Four-man rush. Stands in there. Goes to Crowder. And Crowder down near the sticks. Inside the 16-yard line. And it looks like he's got a first down, and he does.
And you're starting to see the level of specialist that's playing at Duke has the quicks that you expect to see from ACC football. Crowder, a guy who in space can make people move, can make people miss, and now because they have a guy like Kinnett that they can bring in and do some different stuff, Duke becoming more and more diverse because they're starting to get some athletes that when you get them the ball, things happen.
Kinnett is in as a wide receiver. Excuse me, Renfrey is a wide receiver, and Kinnett goes to a wildcat, and this one isn't going to work. Malik Beaumont was there. So they send Renfrey out as a flanker. Don't know how much damage he's going to do in that position.
And Kinnett's got to get out of that play. Cincinnati had the defense shifted over to that side. There's an extra man. And I wouldn't be surprised if that's what Coach Cutcliffe is saying, is if you count the numbers to that side, you got to go the other way. I was just outnumbered by Cincinnati.
Second and 12, Renfrey back to take the snap. Dumps it off to Snead. Makes one man miss, makes another man miss, and dives forward to about the 12-yard line. Great effort by Josh Snead, the 5'9 sophomore.
Tough job catching the snap by Renfrey. Nothing there, and they pick up some positive yardage. And now, remember, they threw that post pattern earlier that was intercepted. You have two receivers to the top, including Vernon, back in the game. I wouldn't be surprised if they're looking something to the top here in the pass game.
Third and long. Over the middle. Touchdown! Jordan, they're going to say the ball came out. And Cincinnati has it at the one. Jalay Duncan looked like he had a touchdown, but Greg Blair was there to take it away. Holy cow, what a play that was. They're going to mark it an inch away from the goal line.
Unbelievable. Great read by Renfrey. He was looking to his left. Nothing was there. And there's, you know, I said it before about the helmet-to-helmet contact, but I think that, again, is you can see Blair with the helmet-to-helmet, and that's where the ball comes out, was because of that contact. It's a difficult call to make, but that could have been, just like we were saying, on a Duke defender, that could have been a penalty on Blair as well.
You know, I think going forward, they're really going to have to make this a little clearer. Any contact.
I agree.
Above the shoulder is going to have to be a foul, or we're going to be questioning virtually every tackle.
And it is impossible for a defender going in like that. It's just the natural thing. But you can see the impact on the play right there, and you can see the helmet, and that's what causes the fumble. It was not a hit on the ball that caused the fumble. It was a helmet-to-helmet hit, and as Duncan's head was knocked to the right, the ball came out.
And a big run for Wynn. He gets it out from the shadow of the goal line to near the 10. Wynn again.
quarterback out in front throwing a block, and Wynn driven out of bounds. Brendan Kay had a step on the running back, and he said, what the heck? Let's just go out here and go hunt somebody.
Well, it's Kay who got the spark started with the run on the last drive. So it's almost like this guy is saying, look, I came to play. He's got to fix his pads quickly before he goes out the block. Always smart to do. Pretty good job. Kept his feet. That's all you asked for.
Think of this turnaround. It could be easily 23-3 right now. Instead, it's 16-3 in Cincinnati trying to mount another drive. You're going to get another huge dose of 32.
Well, and that is the ball carrier who fumbled at the goal line, Jalay Duncan, who's being taken into the locker room. Well, no speculation here, but let's just say that it was a helmet-to-helmet hit that caused the fumble. The ball came loose when Blair's helmet hit the helmet of Duncan.
Second and 7 for Cincinnati. Four-man rush. They swing it to Abernathy, and he's taken down after a very modest gain. And again, C.J. French, who has been very active as a linebacker. Duke plays a 4-2-5 defense. They have three safeties on the field and use one of them as a rover. That means they don't stop the run all that well because they're trying to protect against the pass.
And here you are at Cincinnati. Now you're behind the sticks again. This is shocking how much Duke has been dominating this game in the first half.
Okay. Pressure coming. He'll get the first down and more out of bounds to the 46-yard line. And there is going to be a foul against Cincinnati. There was a late block that may have been a low block, even close to a clip.
And I think that this is a good call by the officials because the quarterback was going out of bounds and giving himself up and went in late and got a cut block on Anthony. On Anthony Young Wiseman. And I think this is the right call. I think they're going to get a personal foul on Wynn for going in. The Kay had given himself up, so the defense starts to let up. Wynn was hustling. I don't think this is a dirty play at all.
Personal foul, clipping, 32 of the offense. It's a 15-yard penalty, repeat third down.
Now, I'm a little surprised. I thought it was a dead ball foul.
I did too.
I thought they had the first down.
But what they called, watch the helmet. They're saying that he goes to the back of the knee. This is the right call. Because the defender, I think it could have gone either way. I think it could have been a personal foul for a late hit. But this is a clipping call because you clearly see that Wynn is going to the back of the knee of Young Wiseman.
I'm not questioning the call at all. Right. I'm questioning the fact it should have been a dead ball foul on a first down. Instead, they're saying it's third down.
Well, I think either call is right, but you're right. Dead ball would have been automatic first down. This is just the foul itself.
So, I mean, it's a difficult situation. It would have either been first and 25, but now it's third down and long.
Yeah, and I think either call is fine, but I can see why they called the clipping.
Absolutely. Blitz coming. And they got Brendan Kay back at the 21. Well, Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, says, boy, I don't like the blitz. It puts our guys in bad situations. But he is reverting to instinct, reverting to form. He said, let's go get him.
Well, I think it's almost the same idea as you have with the running game. You bring the linebackers, so now your offensive linemen have to come off and block them, and then who comes off is your defensive line. I think it's the same thing. Let's surprise them a bit. And Cincinnati did see some blitz from Duke through the year, so they prepared, but that was a good timely call.
This time, Duke does not come after them, but a low line drive kick is taken by Crowder. So even though they didn't apply pressure, they got the punter to get off a bad returnable kick.
Give and take, we catch our breaks, we are. This is Karen and Jeremiah. They don't know it yet, but they're gonna fall in love. Get married, have a couple of kids, move to the country, and live a long, happy life together where they almost never fight about money. Because right after they get married, they'll find some retirement people who are paid on salary, not commission. They'll get straightforward guidance and be able to focus on other things, like each other, which isn't rocket science, it's just common sense. From TD Ameritrade.
Tis the season for lighting up the scoreboard as Baylor's top-ranked offense squares off with UCLA's high-flying attack. Capital One Bowl Week continues with a Bridgepoint Education Holiday Bowl. Tonight at 9:45 on ESPN, college football lives here.
Risk their lives, saving the gators they love.
Every gator I catch is a gator that doesn't die.
Gator Boys, Sundays at 9 starting January 6th, Channel 282, Animal Planet, surprisingly human.
These new phones they got us are great.
Yeah, it's the Galaxy Note 2.
You can do two things at the same time. You watch videos and text.
Or you could watch the earnings report and take notes, like we're supposed to.
So, can I get it?
Yeah. Great. Either of you put together the earnings reports yet?
Yes, me. Totally.
What? Why don't you tackle the next quarter? You eat it?
Polynesian?
Poo-poo platter?
Yep. Keep up the good work.
I will keep up the good work.
Do more with the new Samsung Galaxy Note 2.
We need to run the football. It'll be interesting to see if we can run the football.
Well, he's got his answer. Sometimes that's a little bit of a coach's cliche.
Sure.
You got to start, you got to stop the run, you got to be able to run it. And that's not been the case for Duke, but 76 yards on the ground so far for the Blue Devils. Of course, they've got Kinnett in the Wildcat. But this has been a surprise to. I'd be shocked if David Cutcliffe isn't smiling a little bit, thinking, boy, I didn't know if we'd be able to get the running game going quite
a
this
little good. Bit?
Yeah.
Ear to ear. Even coaches who know they can't run say we've got to run the football.
Yeah.
Boy, Snead again. He's been impressive, taking down near midfield. Here's Janine.
Well, Mike and Ed, they're lucky that Josh Snead is back out there because the trainers have been tending to his neck. They had him laying on the training table working on him. But it looks like they have lost one running weapon, and that's Jayla Duncan after that helmet-to-helmet hit. He is out of the game for now.
And, of course, with the loss of the safety, Jordan Bias, at least until halftime. That's two players from helmet down the pits that Duke may lose for this game.
Somehow Crowder got out of that jam and turned that into a positive play. Looked for all the world like he was going to be caught for a 2 or 3 yard loss.
This guy has some shake, doesn't he?
Does that.
Huge game at the end of the season against Miami. 8 catches for 203 yards. And he's a guy that you can tell they're going to start developing. Just a sophomore. This is an awfully bright future for Duke, especially the offensive side of the ball with some of the guys are starting to collect.
Well, Crowder had 1,025 yards coming in. You don't do that if you're taken down by everybody that hits you. Thompson in at running back. Renfrey takes off. And Renfrey to the Cincinnati 44. Close to the sticks again.
You got to go for it here. Bowl game time, and here goes Duke going fast. If you're going to go for it, just go right now. And they've been able to run the ball between the tackles. I'm not sure you need to mess around too much if you're Cutcliffe. David Cutcliffe and his offensive coordinator, Kurt Roper. I'd be surprised if this isn't just a power run.
Didn't look like the greatest mark either.
No.
And they'll go Wildcat. Kinnett comes in, Snead's coming.
Well, they're going to have to call timeout, I think, if they don't get going here.
Clock's running
bad
down.
Bad management. Yeah, they didn't know what they wanted to do. It seemed like they knew right away they were going to go for a fourth, but didn't know what package they wanted.
It's the second time Kinnett has come in and looked unsure of what to call.
Capital One Cash Rewards Card gives you 1% cash back on all purchases, plus a 50% annual bonus, and everyone but her likes 50% more cash, but I'm up in my game.
You want a candy cane?
Yeah.
Do you want the puppy?
Yeah.
Do you want a tricycle?
Yes.
Do you want 50% more cash?
No.
Festive.
The Capital One Cash Rewards card gives you 1% cash back on every purchase, plus a 50% annual bonus on the cash you earn. It's the card for people who like more cash.
That's how you love it.
Nobody tells stories about that punt on 4th and 1. Nobody relives that miraculous fair catch or taking a knee. And nobody remembers the guy who brought cheese and crackers.
Late night whipping it, we're magnificent. Yeah, I go hard in the fourth quarter.
6 crunchy tacos and 6 Doritos Locos tacos. Taco Bell Variety Taco 12 Pack. A game day tradition since right now.
Hershey's Drops. A lot of Hershey's happiness in little drops of milk chocolate and cookies and cream. Pure Hershey's.
Are we doing okay here?
Absolutely.
And what can I get for you?
I'll have one of those.
At ProjectLuna.com.
In my playing days, I was known for keeping calm in the face of chaos. But now, I'm more relaxed than ever, thanks to my new Relax Fit shoes from Skechers.
My purse! Somebody help me, please!
They keep you relaxed in any situation.
New Relax Fit Skechers.
ESPN College Football, the Belk Bowl, is brought to you by the Capital One Cash Rewards Card with a 50% annual bonus. And Taco Bell. Sometimes you gotta live Mas.
Duke and Cincinnati both got the chance to visit the Richard Petty driving experience at Charlotte Motor Speedway. Players and coaches got a 3-lap ride along with a driver.
Well, we looked at the spot. The spot was actually very good.
It was.
So the right spot. Now I just think it's got to be an inside run for Duke.
Thompson, the running back. He'll get the carry, and he's not going to get it. Cincinnati stacked the line and came up big on defense. The first guy there was Nick Temple, number 43, an explosive linebacker. The only thing you wonder about that, it took a while for that run to develop.
Watch the top of your screen. You talk about explosive. That was an inside stunt by Temple. He was going one-on-one with David Reeves, the tight end, and Steve Stripling, remember, interim defensive coordinator, defensive line coach. He knew what I thought, too. It's going to be an inside run, so let's pinch some people from the outside. And Temple gets to do a little dance because he made a nice move to the inside for the tackle for loss.
With 6:10 to go in the first half, you've got to think this is a huge possession for Cincinnati, especially after getting the ball back. And Tompkins dives to make the catch at the 36. That ball was thrown to the open space, and Tompkins ran under it.
Boy, that's nice adjustment to the ball and got his hands underneath. But give Cincinnati's defense credit, because if Duke picks that up and goes down and scores, this thing could have gotten out of hand.
Wynn on the read option to the 30. Kelsey, the tight end, gave him a good block. Kelsey has not been much of a factor in the passing game, and he is their leading receiver with 40 catches coming in. Caught a couple of short ones and was tattooed by Bias both times.
And he is a sensational blocker. Good hands, good ball skills. This is a guy, senior, who's going to play at the next level. And you see him move around. He's now lined up as a slot receiver. Talented guy.
Brother Jason with the Eagles. He was recruited as a quarterback. They switched him to tight end. That's the way he's going to make his living. There's Wynn fighting for extra yards and may have the first down.
Well, and that was a case of Cincinnati and offensive coordinator T.J. Weiss trying to get the edge on Duke. They brought Kelsey in motion. They already had a tight end to that side. And I'm really impressed with Wynn, a guy who is a good special teams player. And I think you're in a situation here. Well, the officials are trying to I think, figure out if this was a first down or not. They marked it. We had it pushed as a first. It was a first. And give the official to that side credit. He realized that they hadn't flipped over to first, so he went to the referee and made sure they corrected it to get it to first and 10. And unfortunately for Cincinnati, the game clock has been moving this entire time.
Has. They lost 30, 40 seconds there. Kay after the pump fake. Now being chased. Got a block. Has it tipped up in the air and incomplete. Duke applying really good pressure on Brendan Kay. Wynn with a peelback block to keep him alive for a while.
And as tough as Duke has had it in their secondary, especially in those last four ball games, that was coverage. There was not a blitz. Canty came up late because the quarterback had nowhere to go. But that was just solid coverage all the way across the board.
Well, Duke is a defense 103 in the country against the run, 96 against the pass. In total, defense are 104. But they're playing out of their mind tonight. Second and 10 for Cincinnati. Kay with time to the end zone. Touchdown. A perfect strike to Anthony McClung. The slot receiver with his second scoring catch of the year. Nice throw by Brendan Kay.
And he saw exactly what he wanted on that one, where he had one-on-one coverage against young Weissman. The nickelback lined up over on the slot. He saw the one-on-one and knew he had it beat. And that was, it was also thrown perfectly on time.
Yes.
Right when McClung made his move, that ball was in the air.
Miliano for the point after. And Cincinnati, after spotting Duke a big lead, has closed the gap to 6 points on the Brendan Kay touchdown pass.
Recently, students from 31 countries took part in a science test. The top academic performers surprised some people. So did the country that came in 17th place. Let's raise the bar and elevate our academic standards. Let's do what's best for our students by investing in our teachers. Let's solve this.
Sundays at 9, starting January 6th, Channel 282, Animal Planet, surprisingly human.
This is awesome.
Folks who save hundreds of dollars switching to Geico sure are happy.
I'd say happier than a slinky on an escalator.
Get happy. Get Geico.
Dylan! Help! Oh,
well, that was uncalled for.
Folks who save hundreds of dollars switching to Geico sure are happy.
How happy, Ronnie?
Happier than Gallagher at a farmer's market.
Get happy. Get Geico.
Six is what they call, baby.
Cincinnati has cut the lead to six here at the Belk Bowl in Charlotte. Now let's take a look at tonight's Reese's perfect play. Ed.
Well, McClung is the second receiver, and even though there are four defenders to the side, he's going to end up one-on-one with young Anthony Young Weissman. And watch the move McClung makes right there. Tiny move to the outside and pretty good recovery by Young Weissman. But because he didn't quite get his hips opened enough, and because of that outside move, and we mentioned the timing of the throw. Again, not bad coverage, but because the throw was made on time, young Weissman just didn't quite have enough time to make the recovery. But that was a nice shake move that time by McClung.
Cincinnati offense.
Shout out to Naptown.
A little more production of late.
Fumble inside the one by Duke, and a big stop by Cincinnati defensively on their side of the field on fourth down, and all of a sudden it's a ball game.
Capital One Bowl Week continues tomorrow with three games. At 2, Ohio will take on Louisiana Monroe in the AdvoCare V100 Independence Bowl. And at 5:30, Rutgers faces Virginia Tech in the Russell Athletic Bowl. And at 9, Minnesota and Texas Tech square off in the Meineke Car Care Bowl of Texas. Capital One Bowl Week tomorrow on ESPN, also live on Watch ESPN.
Of course, Tommy Tuberville coming from Texas Tech to coach Cincinnati next year, which I think was a terrific hire, shocking hire, quite frankly. Nobody saw it coming, but Cliff Kingsbury now coaching Texas Tech.
Snead wrapped up, only got back to the line of scrimmage.
Well, you've got to think Cincinnati's going to get a little energy with what their offense just did. This is, they came out, they started getting punched around a little bit. We've seen some communication issues, which we expected from the start with the pared down staff. But you've got to figure they're getting settled in a little bit now that they've made a few things happen.
Four-man rush on Renfrey. Hangs in the middle. Scott made the catch and was drilled. The ball came loose. No whistle. Cincinnati football. Cincinnati touchdown. Clemente Cassius, 38 yards. The hit by Drew Fry. There is a flag down, but that's after the play, I believe, a celebration penalty perhaps. But we got to figure out if this was a catch and a fumble or an incomplete or whatever. And they're talking about it. They did the right thing by letting the play continue. This way you can go back and fix it if you made a mistake. Otherwise, you can't.
And that is such a key thing, because a turnover is such a competitive advantage that if it happens, you would rather, as an official, let the play go, because you always know. And I like what the official did. What they do is they throw the beanie bag down at the 34-yard line so they know if it wasn't a fumble, we know exactly where we're coming back to.
They already showed it once on the Jumbotron, and the Duke fans reacted. This is either going to be incomplete or complete and not a fumble, because the receiver hit the ground.
Ruling on the field, we have an interception and a touchdown. However, during the play, we have an illegal block below the waist by the original offense, number 19. That 15-yard penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
Now we'll go back and take a look.
And now let's see the hit by Fry. We've been talking about hits all day. Now, and once again, we see helmet-to-helmet contact. But that ball, I'm not sure it ever hit the ground. Watch Scott as he rolls over. Again, helmet-to-helmet, that could have been called. Ball hits the ground right there. This is an incomplete pass.
Incomplete pass.
But again, going back to, and it is so hard, but this is, by rule,
he is a defenseless receiver.
Yeah, by rule, that is a penalty on Fry. And again, it is so hard to coach a player that's running full speed at another player to not duck their head, but this is helmet to helmet. Well, targeting at the shoulders above. And the other part of this, too, is Fry leaves his feet. That's the other part of the penalty you're supposed to call. The defender, if he leaves his feet, it's considered launching, and that's targeting.
If you're going to have this rule, if you're going to say helmet to helmet is an automatic foul, especially against a defenseless receiver, then you got to call it.
I know. It's tough.
You have to call it every time.
And that's really, That's a really tough one. Remember, we're watching that frame by frame.
I agree.
But when you watched it at regular speed, it did look like Fry hit with his shoulder. It looked like good technique, and I'm not faulting Fry because this is a very difficult and touchy thing, and I think you're right. It's very confusing. But because there was, his head was down, and he ended up making contact with the helmet. If the player lowers his head and targets, they're supposed to call that. It's a tough one. I see why they didn't.
But wouldn't you agree that if this is going to be done for safety, and that's the movement to prevent concussions, prevent hits like that, you've got to call it every time, whether it's controversial or not. If you even think they did
After
it,
review, the ball hit the ground before the ball was intercepted. Therefore, we have an incomplete pass. However, we will still enforce the dead ball personal foul number 19 from the previous spot.
Ooh, that's
huge.
It'll
be third down at the 13 and a half yard line.
But and the right thing to do.
You can't let it go.
No, you cannot let it go. because the foul happened. And because it was, anytime there is a change of possession, which happens in the kicking game, and you watch Renfrey coming in right there. He cannot go low, whether you're on offense or defense. When there is a change of possession in either the kicking game or a turnover, you cannot go below the waist. Neither team can go below the waist. I would assume what they're talking about is with the enforcement where the ball will end up and what the down and distance is.
The line of scrimmage had been the 26.
Please reset the game clock to 3:22. 3:22.
It's going to be half the distance to the goal, but from where the foul occurred. Isn't that correct?
It should be.
From the line of scrimmage?
Yeah, from the previous spot. Right, which the referee said, so it goes from the previous spot.
Well, the upshot of the whole thing is Duke is back at the 13-yard line with third and a mile. Renfrey wants to throw, goes underneath, and got it to his backup quarterback, Brandon Kinnett. That's Kinnett's third catch. So the previous line of scrimmage had been the 26th. The penalty marked back half the distance to the goal of the 13. And but now it's fourth and 17. So we have done the housekeeping.
Well, and you see the defensive line coach, interim head coach Steve Stripling. The intensity level has turned up here for Cincinnati. And all of a sudden, the momentum that was so clearly on Duke's side, I think, is completely flipped over to Cincinnati's side.
Will Monday, the first team all ACC punter, crushes one.
What a, oh my.
Holy mackerel.
Oh my, that ball did not go out of bounds. What a punt.
Well, I'll bet that's a Belk Bowl record. It only went 79 yards.
And it tightrope walked down the sideline.
Oh,
it caught an edge and somehow didn't go out of bounds.
What a punt.
Watch this ball as it starts to roll and doesn't go out of bounds. Oh, that's so close. We might have another review. Still a great punt even if it did.
Yes, it was. We'll check the replays when we come back.
I'm a mama's boy.
Punch brings my family together. I usually talk longer with my mother. My bill is always flat, it's always the same. No extra cost, no limits on the time, so it just works very good. Everybody has a favorite in their family, and I'm pretty sure I'm the one for my mom, so. Mi nombre es Raul Santoyo, and my mom is why I switched to Punch.
Get unlimited calling to Mexico and over 60 countries for one low price from any phone.
In 2D and 3D, January 4th.
Sometimes what we suffer from is bigger than we think, like the flu.
With aches, fever, and chills, the flu's a really big deal. So why treat it like it's a little cold? There's something that works differently than over-the-counter remedies. Prescription Tamiflu attacks the flu virus at its source. So don't wait. Call your doctor right away. Tamiflu is prescription medicine for treating the flu in adults and children 1 year and older whose flu symptoms started within the last 2 days. Before taking Tamiflu, tell your doctor if you're pregnant, nursing, have serious health conditions, or take other medicines. If you develop an allergic reaction, a severe rash, or signs of unusual behavior, stop taking Tamiflu and call your doctor immediately. Children and adolescents in particular may be at an increased risk of seizures, confusion, or abnormal behavior. The most common side effects are mild to moderate nausea and vomiting. The flu comes on fast, so ask your doctor about Tamiflu, prescription for flu.
Icebreakers.
I'm Reese Davis. Coming up on the Reese's Halftime Report, San Jose State finished a remarkable turnaround with their bowl victory today. We'll show you the highlights. Matt Barkley's career is over at USC. We'll put that in perspective. He will not be able to play in the Sun Bowl against Georgia Tech. And we'll also look ahead to the Holiday Bowl tonight, Baylor and UCLA. So, Mike, what's going on with that punt?
Reese? The replay is unbelievable. It may not be undisputable, but it's unbelievable. That thing tiptoed along the sideline and was down at the one. Cincinnati will take over there. 2:28 to go in the half. Kay wants to throw out of the end zone. Incomplete pass to diving Ken Brell Tompkins. Watch this replay.
We watched this about a dozen times during the break, and I think that the field judge, Greg Thomas, got this right. I didn't see the ball touch the white, but watch the finish here. Isaac Blakeney right there puts his left hand on the ball and stops the ball from moving. What a great hustle play. Now, a lot of people are saying, well, wait, he was in the end zone. It should be a touchback. No, in college football, it's only where the ball is. Yep. So that was an excellent job by Blakeney to finish that play. What a punt.
You throw again or to try to get some punting room. Win. Swallowed up by that Blue Devil defense at the three, led by the charge of Justin Fox out of Charlotte. And this is such a huge game for Duke, a prime recruiting area for them. They've got a lot of players already from Charlotte, and this would be a coup.
And you can win this game. And a game where the momentum had switched back to Cincinnati, that punt puts it back to Duke's side. And with a minute 55 and two timeouts, Cincinnati, I think they've got to think about throwing the ball here, even from their own end zone, because you give this ball back to Duke, they've got two timeouts and some momentum. You may be looking at a two-score deficit going into halftime.
David Cutcliffe compares Mundy to the Colquitt brothers, who he had at Tennessee. That is high praise.
Timeout, Cincinnati. The third and final timeout of the half.
Because the kicking Colquitts were some family. But a 79-yarder will turn the field every time. The Discover Orange Bowl on ESPN New Year's Day. Number 15, Northern Illinois against number 12, FSU. The Discover Orange Bowl, Tuesday, 8:30 on ESPN, as well as live on the Watch ESPN app and ESPN Radio.
Of course, we have another season after this with the BCS, and a lot of people say, oh, Northern Illinois didn't deserve to get in. You know what I say to that?
Yes, they did.
Absolutely. Absolutely. If you haven't seen Jordan Lynch play, you're in for a treat. I'm not so sure that they have the athletes up front to beat Florida State, but let's not forget, Florida State will mail in a game every now and then. And this is a game that, of course, Oklahoma was in the mix to get in there, and all of a sudden you get Northern Illinois, and Florida State may be saying, eh.
They mailed in a couple with no postage this year.
Yeah, so, you know, I get tired of hearing that. Northern Illinois did exactly what the rules said they had to do to get in, and Jordan Lynch has had a guy who came out of nowhere to have a tremendous season.
Interesting situation here with 1:34 left in the half. Third and eight. What do you call if you're the Bearcats?
The safe call is a screen, but that has not worked very well for them so far today.
Kay from his end zone.
Going to have to run. And Kay, first down and more.
What a great play by Kay. It was all coverage. He had good time. This happens because of the pass protection by the offensive line. No blitz this time by Duke. They play coverage. The defensive line gets out of their rush lanes, and because it took a long time for that play to develop, all the Duke defensive backs have turned and run. Big, big play for Cincinnati to not have to turn that ball over with this much time and two timeouts left for Duke.
And no timeouts for Cincinnati. So first downs and getting out of bounds will be key on this drive. Delayed blitz. Kay throws to the outside. Tompkins couldn't hold it. Good defense by Tony Foster.
And this is exactly what you're going to have to throw if you're Cincinnati without any timeouts. You're going to have to throw over to the side. That is nice coverage right there. And Tompkins wanted pass interference, but you're going to let guys go with the hands a little bit, especially if both guys are doing it. So that was just good, hard coverage.
Kenbrell Tompkins, big-time receiver coming out of high school, signed with Tennessee, but then when there was a coaching change, he wanted out of his scholarship. They wouldn't let him. He ended up going to El Camino Community College and then to Cincinnati. He has great skill, and Foster was all over him. Kay again floats it. Wide open, caught at the 40-yard line. Anthony McClung got loose in the secondary for 31 yards.
Well, McClung crossed the entire field, and the safety on that side for Duke was late getting over there. Excuse me, that's the cornerback, Ross Cockrell, who came over out of control. Cockrell was trying to rotate to the deep coverage, and because he ran over a little bit out of control, McClung once again able to run by him. McClung looks like he's got a good feel of how to run routes.
Nobody has given up bigger plays and more of them than Duke this year. Caught at the one, touchdown. Ralph David Abernathy beat Kyler Brown. The grandson of the legendary civil rights leader racing down the sideline, found the ball and made the adjustment. Partially blocked, and it got through. What a turnaround. As much as Duke has dominated this first half, Cincinnati has just taken the lead.
This is exactly, if you're going to have a little back in the backfield that's going to run routes, this is exactly what you want. And I give Kyler Brown all the credit in the world. He saw Abernathy coming into the backfield, and he turned and sprinted as fast as he could towards the end zone. But unfortunately, there's no linebacker in the country in one-on-one coverage with the speed of Abernathy that they're going to be able to run with him. And give Brendan Kay credit. He got this team into it with a tough run earlier in the game, and it was that run on third and eight from inside the 10-yard line that kept this drive going.
He took him 98 yards in a minute 46 with no timeouts.
And he saw Abernathy one-on-one with a linebacker. Right away, he threw that ball. He threw a sky ball. He wanted to get it out of his hands. He knew he had exactly what he wanted. He laid it out there for Abernathy to run under. And again, I give Kyler Brown, the linebacker, credit from Duke. He saw it too. Just it was the perfect call by Cincinnati.
Problem was he saw it and couldn't do anything about it. Abernathy could. And you're right about the throw. It was terrific. And now it's Duke's turn to be stunned. Cincinnati was early as Duke got the first 16 points. The Bearcats have the last 17. Scott and Karun Rune are deep. Scott runs into his own man, taken down shy of the 20. take a look at our Buick Drive recap.
Well, it started on a third and eight when Cincinnati had no choice but to call a drop back pass, and Brendan Kay read it perfectly, took off, picked up big yardage, and then the problem for Duke all year has been the big plays. This one to McClung when Cockrell got spun around in the coverage, and then of course when you get a little running back that can really fly against a linebacker, you're usually going to win that one. And now for Duke with a senior quarterback and two timeouts, there's no reason not to be going for it here. Put your foot on the gas.
Renfrey throws underneath to Reeves, and he gets out of bounds.
And so now for Duke, with this clock and where you are, you got to start thinking, what's our range? Well, you know, in talking to the David Cutcliffe, they think they can kick about a 60-yard field goal with Ross Martin. So you get across midfield, and you're going to start to look for a field goal. For Duke, I think you've got plenty of time, and manage the clock. Don't let any clock run with these timeouts. Just get it stopped if you have to.
This play taking a long time. Renfrey gets out of bounds after he couldn't find a receiver, and the clock is down to 22.
And David Cutcliffe right now doing what all coaches do at this time is you start counting plays. How many plays can we run? And you figure between 5 and 8 seconds per play. So you're looking at about 3 or 4 plays. So to maybe get in Ross Martin territory, 5, 6, 7 yards, and remember to use those timeouts.
You'll need a 20-yarder in there somewhere.
Yes, you are.
Draw play. Thompson.
What a great
Thompson
play.
Got out of bounds at the 40.
I always like the draw call in a 2-minute situation, a hurry up situation. The defensive line is coming so hard and so fast. If you get them to run by you, you usually can get a good gap. And when it was third and short, you get the first down. Remember, college football, the clock stops. So even if you just get past it, everyone's already around the ball. You can get the next playoff.
20 more yards, and they've got a long shot field goal, and Renfrey throws over the middle. The closest guy to it was Connor Vernon, but he was covered well, and he missed him by about 10 yards.
Well, now is where you want that 20-yarder you were talking about.
Yep.
I'm not sure you're going to be able to get 3 plays off, so if you're thinking 2, because from here you'd obviously your last play would be throw one down the field for a touchdown. But, something across the middle, it's called a dig route, where Connor Vernon runs about 12 yards and runs right across the middle of the field.
There's Connor Vernon. He's down to the 40, fighting for extra yards. He's got to go down, and they've got to get the timeout. They do. Perfect. After 36 with 3 seconds left to go. Now you've got a chance, maybe 53 yards.
Perfect play, perfect read. And this is how perfect is it if you're Duke that Renfrey, who's been a 3-year starter, throws to a guy who's the ACC's all-time leading receiver. 4 years this guy has been doing it at a high level, runs a great route, finds exactly where the coverage is not in the middle of the field, and then how key is this? Picks up about 5 more yards, which is going to make a big deal in the field goal.
I thought Cincinnati was going to hold him up
and try to get
the clock. The clock might have run out because Connor Vernon did not get him give himself up.
Yep.
He got the extra yardage, but fortunately for him, he also got yeah. off his feet. And now they've got a shot, and we'll tell you again that Ross Martin, according to David Cutcliffe, one of the most talented kickers he has ever had. He's 18 out of 20 this year. His long is 50, but he said his range is 60.
Well, 19 out of 21 because he nailed one earlier. So this guy's having a great year.
Yes, he is.
What a nice use of the clock and a change.
This is not meant to jinx anybody, but Jackson Anderson, the snapper, David Cutcliffe said he has not had a bad snap in 4 years.
Cincinnati getting a late addition on their defense out.
This will be from 53. Perfect snap. Good hold. The kick. Did Cincinnati get a timeout? They don't have a timeout.
Did they get a delay of game on this field goal?
Prior to the snap, illegal substitution on the defense, 12 men in the formation. 5-yard penalty, still first down. Please reset the game clock to 3 seconds.
Holy cow.
Wow.
Holy.
And God. David Cutcliffe is so mad.
Oh, he's beside himself.
That they called this.
I mean, it gives him 5 yards, sure, but your guy just hit a 53-yard field goal. To me, this is against the spirit of the rule.
Well,
spirit
no.
Spirit of the game.
I understand, but you have to throw the flag. I mean, that's when it's an illegal substitution, you don't have to. Because what happens if he misses the kick and you didn't call it?
I understand.
Yeah. Well, you know what? David Cutcliffe has said this is the most talented kicker he's ever had. Now let's see if he has some ice in his veins to nail another one in Duke's first bowl game since the mid-90s. But I can understand the frustration of David Cutcliffe.
Absolutely. So he makes the 53-yarder. You take it off the books. Now he'll try from 48. It's closer to 49. No good. By a foot wide left. How's that for heartbreak? Boy, what a ball game. We've had a little bit of everything in this thing. Both teams used the same tunnel. Cincinnati's supposed to go off first. They did. Here's Duke, David Cutcliffe with Janine.
Coach, quite a turn of events there. You're not happy right now. What's going through your mind?
Well, I'm not very pleased. That's the way you ice a kicker without a timeout, sending a player on late. So I'm bothered by that we have a field goal good. And that should be unsportsmanlike, in my opinion. But that's my opinion. Other than that, I'm really not pleased that we can't make a fourth and a half yard at a very critical time of the game and that we turn the ball over going in. We're going to correct some of those things and come back out and play better football. And if we also get somebody pinned back inside their 1 yard line, play a little better defense.
Well, you really fired your guys up with your pregame speech. They came out on a mission. How do you recapture that and get them to start the second half the same way?
Well, I'm going to go get their attention right now, and we're going to come back out and play well the second half.
Thanks, Coach.
Here is the field goal that was made but didn't count, a 53-yarder that made it by that much. And then David Cutcliffe being told, hey, that's not going to count because we had an illegal substitution.
And what he said to Janine was he felt like it was unsportsmanlike that Cincinnati ran a player on and got an illegal substitution, which can ice your kicker. I'm not so sure that's the case. Remember, Cincinnati has a small staff of coaches. There may have clearly been some confusion whether the young man should have been on the field or not.
And I wouldn't want to give him 5 extra yards to kick it from 48.
No, I'd rather 53. I agree.
At the half, it's 17-16. Now we send you to Reese Davis with the Reese's Halftime Report.
All right, Mike, Lou Holtz, Mark May are here, 17-16. So a bizarre ending to the half, but really it was the beginning of the half that you were most impressed with the Blue Devils.
Absolutely. The way they finished the season, they were bowl eligible in their 8th game this season, and they proceeded to lose 4 consecutive games by giving up at least 42 points in each one of those games. David Cutcliffe and his staff did a terrific job getting this football team prepared to play in this bowl game, coming out, scoring the first 16 points in this football game, and they should have had the lead at halftime. That's a bad job by the officials. I thought that was unsportsmanlike. I agree with David Cutcliffe.
Well, I thought David Cutcliffe right there in the interview before half says volumes about it. I mean, he's the leader on that football team. He isn't looking for any excuses. He's not pleased with some things happening. Yet at the same time, Duke played very, very well in certain areas. On the other hand, I absolutely think it's unfair to the players for Cincinnati or anybody else not to have a head football coach, to have an interim coach, et cetera, without the leadership. Nothing against the coaches at Cincinnati. They're moving on. But David Cutcliffe is providing the leadership. That's why Duke's in this ball game.
You know, I think when you talk about that penalty at the end, I'm sure the officials called it by the book. I think what you'd like, you know what you'd like to see there, Mark?
You'd like to see it
be a flag play on, and then you get to decide
Absolutely.
At the end of the play. There may be a safety issue, though, when you talk about running a 12th guy onto the field, so perhaps that's the thinking. I think the thing I was most disappointed about in the first half.
What?
How can you waste that 79-yard punt? They had 79 yards. They down it on the 2, and you let them walk down the field in 6 plays.
That punter must be a basketball player.
That's the best punt I've seen in years. I mean, it curled right out, right along the sideline and just went all the way down inside the 3-yard line and just stopped.
All right, we've got a good one going. Second half coming not too far away. Cincinnati with a 17-16 lead. We'll show you how San Jose State completed a remarkable turnaround. Spartans, too, are looking
to start over with a new coach soon.
This halftime report is brought to you by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, the perfect combination of chocolate and peanut butter.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Jack Frost nipping at your nose. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight.
Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas. Merry Christmas to you.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Look, if you have COPD like me, you know it can be hard to breathe and how that feels. COPD includes chronic bronchitis and emphysema. Spiriva helps control my COPD symptoms by keeping my airways open for 24 hours. Plus, it reduces COPD flare-ups. Spiriva is the only once-daily inhaled COPD maintenance treatment that does both.
Spiriva, handy-haler tiotropium bromide inhalation powder, does not replace fast-acting inhalers for sudden symptoms. Tell your doctor if you have kidney problems, glaucoma, trouble urinating, or an enlarged prostate. These may worsen with Spiriva. Discuss all medicines you take, even eye drops. Stop taking Spiriva and seek immediate medical help if your breathing suddenly worsens, your throat or tongue swells, you get hives, vision changes, or eye pain, or problems passing urine. Other side effects include dry mouth and constipation.
Nothing can reverse COPD. Spiriva helps me breathe better.
Ask your doctor about Spiriva.
Mine was earned off Vietnam in 1968.
Over the South Pacific in 1943.
I got mine in Iraq, 2003.
USAA auto insurance is often handed down from generation to generation because it offers a superior level of protection. And because USAA's commitment to serve the military, veterans, and their families is without equal. Begin your legacy. Get an auto insurance quote. USAA, we know what it means to serve.
McDonald's presents the McNuggets Guide to Football. The Blitz. Pass Interference. The Dunk. Nothing goes better with football than McDonald's Chicken McNuggets. 20 golden crispy pieces made with white meat for only $4.99 with spicy buffalo and cool creamy ranch. More good times to love.
Welcome back to the Reese's Halftime Report.
Just a couple of years ago, San Jose State was 1-12. Now in the Military Bowl against Bowling Green, trying to win their 11th game, David Fales succeeds all day. Very successful. Fales to Kyle Nunn, 33 of 43, 395 and two touches. Spartans up 7-0. But this time, Fales would. Chris Jones would scoop it up for the Falcons.
Oh, the big guy. You think he's going to score? Nah.
That's okay. It's got Anton Samuel. Kid out of Opelika, Florida. Dances way 8 yards. And Bowling Green out of the Mid-American Conference. Had a good non-conference season. Did teams from the MAC up 13-10. And then Fales to Chandler Jones. Oh, look at that move, Coach.
Oh, nice move in there. Great effort to get in. Put San Jose State up 19-13.
Fourth quarter, same score. John Pettigrew. Going to pop free.
High and tight with that football. What a terrific run.
Initially ruled a touchdown. They would look at it again, and Pettigrew's knee goes down. So when you make a run like that, Mark, what play should they call next?
Give it right back to Pettigrew. Reward that young man for taking that ball down to the one.
BGTD, 20-19. Later in the fourth, Fails, firing, and has it knocked away. San Jose State would have to settle for a field goal. Now with a 22-20 lead, Matt Shills is going to be sacked. San Jose State recovers, and DeLeon Eskridge will put on the finishing touches, Luke.
Well, for a team that was 118th in the country in rushing offense, they did a great job, San Jose State, today running the ball.
29-20, the final. San Jose State gets its first 11-win season since 1940. And now Ron Carriger, who had been at the University of San Diego, where Jim Harbaugh coached once upon a time, will take over with Mike McIntyre, former coach, who did not coach in this game, McIntyre. He built the program back, went to Colorado as head coach. Matt Barkley will not play for USC against Georgia Tech in the Hyundai Sun Bowl, a shoulder injury suffered against UCLA will keep Barkley out. Barkley tweeting earlier today that doctors have not cleared him, so his glorious career at USC is over, a glorious career overall, but one that ended in a disappointing fashion with five losses this year and Barkley being injured at the end of the season. But in terms of what he meant to USC during a difficult time of probation, Lou, sticking around for one more year, what impact has he had on the Trojan program?
Oh, I think he's had a tremendous impact, not only on the Trojans, but on the entire country. When you consider this, here's an individual, was part of a football team that was hit with probation. I mean a bad probation, yet he stayed there. No, he didn't win the Heisman, but he didn't win the national championship if everybody thought they would. However, he did end up being the leading passer for total offense and touchdowns passes. But more importantly, he provided the leadership at a difficult time. I admire him, I respect him. It'll turn out to be a positive thing for him in the pros.
Mark, when you look, everybody wants to see Matt Barkley play. I get that. Big picture, kind of a good thing for USC that they're going to get more reps for Max Whittick at quarterback?
Absolutely. He gets more practice time. He gets another start under his belt. He had the one start against Notre Dame on a big platform and a big stage. Played well, but didn't play well enough to win that football game. But the good thing is, for Lane Kiffin and USC as this program, you've got another quarterback that's been in the system. He's a redshirt freshman. He started a game. He's getting those practices that he really needs, and now he's going to start the Sun Bowl. So the future looks bright. At least you've got a quarterback that's taken over for a four-year starter that will have game experience. And big-time game experience, as I mentioned, against Notre Dame and now in the Sun Bowl. So if you look at the future, the quarterback position for USC, that's pretty bright.
Boy, I tell you, though, it's great to be a quarterback and have Marquise Lee and Woods there as wide receivers. That's a great asset.
Yeah, no question about it. And that Whittick cat, he can sling that pill through a car wash and it doesn't even get wet. He's got a gun on him now. He can throw the football.
Let me write that down.
You want to use that one in one of your speeches? Add that to the repertoire? He's going to erase it later. The team that beat USC, UCLA, plays in the Holiday Bowl tonight against Baylor. That should be an offensive showcase. We'll take a peek ahead. What's in store for you later on ESPN?
Icebreakers.
Get ready for a big change in tires. Introducing TreadSmart at PepBoys.com. Shop, schedule, and save. Online, anytime. Choose from Pep Boys' huge selection of national tire brands. Buy online, pick a time, and we'll install your tires at Pep Boys 7 days a week. TreadSmart. Information to installation in a click. Pretty smart, huh? TreadSmart at PepBoys.com. Take it for a spin.
We build tires, but not tires like anybody else. We build Cooper tires for people, not just cars. People who are chauffeurs and shuttle pilots, heavy haulers and heavy hitters. More than what your Cooper tires can do, it's about what you can do with your Cooper tires. Life's a road trip. Come on, let's go.
Join us at ProjectLuna.com.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes. And just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
The Discover BCS National Championship on ESPN. The BCS lives here.
Working our way for those BCS games, we got a good one tonight in the Bridgepoint Education Holiday Bowl. Baylor and UCLA kick off around 9:45 Eastern time. We'll take you right up to it. A couple of explosive offenses. Dave Pasch, Brian Greasy will have the call from beautiful San Diego.
The Pac-12 and Big 12 meet in San Diego at Qualcomm Stadium. The Bridgepoint Education Holiday Bowl featuring Baylor and UCLA. Dave Pasch alongside Brian Griese. Baylor loses RG3 after winning the Heisman Trophy, now a Pro Bowl quarterback in the NFL. And a lot of people were wondering how they would survive. Well, they played well down the stretch, and Nick Florence, the new quarterback for Baylor, ends up leading the nation in total offense.
Yeah, he's been outstanding. How hard can it be to follow Robert Griffin III after a Heisman Trophy and all the attention they brought to Baylor University? But Nick Florence has been outstanding. And this offense is a big play offense. It was a big play offense with RG3 throwing the ball down the field. They love play action, double moves in the slot to Tevin Reese. This is an example against Oklahoma a year ago. We know how strong Robert Griffin's arm is. He could make this throw in his sleep. The question coming into this season was, could they continue to play this way? Let's take a look at Nick Florence. Same play, same fake, same move on the inside from the slot from Tevin Reese, and Nick Florence has shown that he can make this throw on a consistent basis. Nick Florence has played about as good as he possibly could in relief of Robert Griffin III.
And on the other side, you got a UCLA team that lost 8 games last year, comes back and wins 9 under first-year coach Jim Mora.
Yeah, Jim Mora has been outstanding. There's no two ways about it. He has infused a belief in this UCLA team and a toughness that, frankly, wasn't there a year ago. But it comes back to their senior running back, Jonathan Franklin. He is their best player, but he's also their hardest worker. And that's what Jim Mora loves about him. He leads from that position. It's going to be very difficult for Baylor to stop Franklin on the ground consistently in this game.
Be hard for UCLA to stop Baylor. Last year, the Bears scored 67 points in their bowl game. And another high-scoring affair expected tonight from San Diego.
Guys, we will look forward to it. A little special teams breakdown for Cincinnati. Duke, the block punt for the touchdown, but the Blue Devils trail by 1. Second half not far away in the Belk Bowl.
Regular appetizers, you'd be sharing them by now. Taco Bell's new loaded grillers. Appetizer taste of spicy wings, tasty skins, and beefy nachos. Each just 99 cents and wrapped up just for you.
They're here, the hottest new machines of 2013, just in time for the Polaris holiday sales event. Get financing as low as 2.99% on all Polaris ATVs and side-by-sides, including the new 2013s. Plus, rebates up to $1,000 on select 2012s. Incredible deals on legendary sportsmen, powerful rangers, and razor-sharp razors. Financing as low as 2.99% and rebates up to $1,000 ends December 31st. Get all the details at Polaris.com.
What'd you get?
Lewis is saving a few bucks.
Same here. Wendy's. So not the same. Going in.
Saving doesn't mean settling. Introducing Wendy's new right price, right size menu. Loaded with big tastes you can't get anywhere else. Starting at 99 cents. Enjoying what you eat and what you pay. That's Wendy's way.
Now that's better.
Well, it's that time of year again. Time to get a holiday deal on a Ram truck. A truck that will pretty much haul anything. With a legendary Hemi engine and proven durability that goes the distance. And while most families bring their tree to the house, Ram families bring their house to the tree. Get a great deal at the Ram Big Finish event.
Get $79.50 in total values or 0% APR for 60 months on the 2012 Ram 1500 Bighorn Crew Cab.
Well, something to keep your eye on tonight, ESPN2, 9 o'clock Eastern Time. New Mexico and number 8 Cincinnati. Lobos of Steve Alford, 12-1. McCronin's team, undefeated so far. New Mexico's won 5 of its last 6 against ranked teams. That'll be at 9 o'clock Eastern Time. Avery Johnson is out of work. You know, he was the NBA Eastern Conference Coach of the Month for end of October, November, now in December. And having won only 3 of the last 14, the Nets fire it.
Jeez. Wow.
P.J. Carlissimo has been named the interim coach after Johnson was dismissed by the Nets. Brendan Kay, beautifully thrown ball to RDA4. Ralph David Abernathy, the fourth going in. And the Bearcats on top by a single.
This halftime report is brought to you by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, the perfect combination of chocolate and peanut butter.
Hershey's make smiles. Smiles make more smiles. When the chocolate is Hershey's, life is delicious.
This holiday at Sprint, get $100 off any 4G LTE tablet when you buy any smartphone. And get a tablet data plan starting at just $10 a month. No sharing required. Hurry into a Sprint store or visit sprint.com/tablet offer today.
I don't know how it happened, but it's okay. We're ready.
When the things that matter most are on the line, make sure we are too. The Fire and Water Cleanup Team at 1-800-SERV-PRO. Like it never even happened.
Oh, man, this is bad. I'm bluffing. I am so bluffing. This is all my rent money.
I'm all in.
Well, it's in there now.
Sweating on the inside? Handle it on the outside with new Speed Stick Power.
Not bad for my first time.
Speed Stick. Don't sweat it. Handle it.
I love the holidays.
And with my Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards credit card, I love them even more.
I earn 1% cash back everywhere, every time.
2% on groceries.
3% on gas. Automatically.
No hoops to jump through.
That's 1% back on...
2% on pumpkin pie.
And apple.
3% back on 4 trips to the airport.
It's as easy as 1, 2, 3.
The Bank AmeriCard Cash Rewards card. Apply online or at a Bank of America near you.
The passion, the pride, the perseverance, the commitment to get cash benefits directly to you when you can really use the money to help pay bills. Like when you're hurt.
Thanks. I needed that.
Aflac, an official partner of the Heisman Trophy.
You're watching ESPN's presentation of Capital One Bowl Week.
Welcome back to the Belk Bowl in Charlotte, North Carolina. Duke had the first 16 points. Cincinnati scored the last 17, and we have a one-point game at the half. Welcome back, everybody. Mike Patrick, Ed Cunningham, Janine Edwards working the sidelines for us. We saw a little bit of everything, including some things that you very rarely see.
Well, and it looked like for a while there that Duke was going to run away with this, which would have been a shocker for everyone in the country, not thinking that Cincinnati, who could win 10 games with a win today, would get blown out by Duke, right, who struggled with 4 losses down the stretch. But it all changed with turnovers. You know, the shocker of shockers. Duke is about to go up by 3 scores when Greg Blair makes a tackle at the goal line and the fumble there by Jalay Duncan. And then Abernathy gets one-on-one coverage with a linebacker, which turns into a touchdown for Cincinnati. And then at the end of the half, a 53-yarder is good by Ross Martin, but an illegal substitution penalty by Cincinnati, which killed the play before the snap, makes a 5-yard penalty, and then the 49-yard field goal, 48-and-a-half, we'll call it, is wide left. So a huge turn for Steve Stripling, the interim head coach for Cincinnati and the Bearcats.
Since that fumble, it has been such a huge momentum changer. 17 plays, 174 yards. That's better than 10 yards per play and 14 points. Let's check in with Janine.
Well, Mike and Ed, I caught up with Cincinnati head coach, interim head coach Steve Stripling, and he told me, you know what? The fact that we are dealing with a half of a coaching staff really showed up in that first half. He said, we don't have 10 decision makers, 10 sets of eyes. We only have 5. And he said, and it was evident, especially with the issues that we had on special teams. Now, he said, we have got to improve our focus for the next 30 minutes. We haven't played very well. We haven't focused very well. And especially, he said, on his side of the ball, defense, they have missed so many tackles. He said, we have got to get that cleaned up. But he is pleased with the play of his quarterback. He said he's shown a lot of patience, guys.
Janine, that's what we speculated about. Usually a lot of teams have special teams by committee. We're down to 4 full-time coaches. You can't even form a committee. That was
Ralph David Abernathy on the return.
Well, one of the things that Cincinnati tries to do to get their run game going, they offset Wynn behind the quarterback, so it's more like an I formation that they run. And then the offensive line, it's just straight zone blocking. This is a power run team. And if you were in the I formation, you'd have a fullback. But because you're in the spread, instead, you bring Travis Kelce across the formation. But here's the thing that George Wynn does, as well as anybody in the country, no wasted steps. If there is a seam, take it and go. When you study this guy on film, he does not mess around. If there's a hole, he's going to take it. And I think that's what Cincinnati needs to get back to here in the second half.
And Kelce is a blocker, is a load, 260 pounds. And Wynn will power forward for about 8 yards. The senior out of Southfield, Michigan, averaged over 100 yards a game this year.
He only had, he's now over 1,000 yards more than he had last year. He had just over 200 yards. Of course, Isaiah Pede was the Big East Offensive Player of the Year at running back for Cincinnati. But you see Kelce that time comes into the middle and basically becomes a fullback. Kelce plays that tight end H-back, comes the lead.
Wynn again, taken down in the backfield. Walt Canty, the safety, shot the gap and got him in the backfield. That's a huge play for Duke. And defensive coordinator Jim Knowles is taking chances when he can and making most of them pay off.
And this is a bust by Cincinnati. There's just no way that McClung, the receiver, is going to get in there. Canty was lined up all the way to the inside. If anything, the quarterback needed to bring McClung closer to the line of scrimmage if that's the guy he's going to block. The alignment for Canty was perfect, and McClung couldn't get there.
It was second and short. Now it's third and long. Big play by McCanny and movement up front. A couple of Cincinnati players moved, a wide receiver and a lineman.
Well, and Austin Gamble did a little shake at the line of scrimmage. And what the officials may be talking about was whether Gamble got into the neutral zone, because if he got into the neutral zone, then it's a foul on the defense. But because I don't believe that Gamble, the linebacker who came up and faked like he was blitzing, did cross the line.
Dead ball, false start. 71 offense, 5-yard penalty. Still third down.
So that'll make it third and 12. And Cincinnati has not distinguished itself on third down tonight. 1 out of 5 so far.
You know, going to third and 12 from third and 7 is not going to make that any easier.
No.
That's a tough one for offensive line, especially in a shotgun formation. A lot of times you are waiting for that defensive end to move. You see that movement and you jump. Gamble a little lucky that he wasn't in the neutral zone, because if he was, they could have called that on the defense.
Duke showing a late blitz. They back out of it and bring three. Now a late fourth. K takes off again. He has the first down and gets out of bounds.
Well, and you can see right there at the end of the play, that's Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, showing frustration. Because at this point, you've seen that the only way we're going to get beat is Brandon Kay. And I think who he's mad at, honestly, is number 45, Austin Gamble. Gamble's the linebacker who they left back as kind of a spy, and he ran up and got caught in the wash. And I think that's what Jim Knowles was upset about. We have a spy. You've got to be the spy.
That's a huge play. It moves the sticks and another set of downs for Cincinnati.
And that spy is needed, because it really, Brandon Kay has been the reason that Cincinnati's gotten us back in this game, is with his ability to run on pass downs.
He has really hurt him. Quick out to McClung, shakes a tackle. McClung across midfield, still on his feet. 30, 20, 15, 10. Duke's inability to tackle in open space has hurt him all year long.
And Brendan Kay got up very slowly, and the referee has picked the flag up. I'm not sure that they're, well, he's going to go down to make the call, but he put the flag back in his pocket.
I think this may be roughing the passer.
Yeah, Brendan Kay was slow to get up.
Personal foul, roughing the passer, 84 defense. Half the distance to the goal, automatic first down.
That's Kenny Onanicki.
First and goal at the 5-yard line.
And there's the missed tackle by Canty. He just overran it, and you made that point. When you make those missed tackles, nice job by number 15, Chris Moore, blocking down the field. But there's Ananicki with the hit, the personal foul hit. Yeah, on the quarterback to add to the play.
Penalty puts it at the 5, first and goal. Wynn down near the goal line. Boy, go back to that third and long where Kay got loose.
I think if you put together his runs tonight, you could say if Cincinnati ends up winning this game. Remember that run in the, I think it was late first quarter?
Absolutely.
They picked up third down. It was a physical run. That got it going.
He also had the run when they were backed up at their two-yard line.
Third,
they kept that drive alive. Low snap, and he didn't get in. Both Kay and Wynn reached for that ball. The snap appeared to be between them.
It did.
They were lucky that ball wasn't fumbled.
Dan Sprague, the center. Little low, but this is a lead play. That was a nice job by Justin Fox, a guy who is going to have knee surgery as soon as this season is over. He already had finger surgery this year. A Duke defense not only hurt in their secondary this season, but had some guys up front banged up as well. I'd expect another run right at that front.
Third and goal, Cincinnati moved.
Oh, that's another mistake. That's Eric Layfelt, who got the illegal procedure earlier that made it third and 12 before Kay converted that one.
Third and inches.
Prior to the snap, false start. 78 offense, 5-yard penalty.
Boy, those are killers.
Still third down.
Well, they called the right tackle. Well, either one. Both tackles got the wrong snap count, apparently. But now,
tackles on one, everybody else on two.
Yeah. But now you go from what was a rundown to a pass down. And the way that Kay has been running the ball, I try to move him out of the pocket.
Shift the strength of the formation to the near side on third and goal. Kay to throw, takes off, has room, caught from behind. A saving tackle by Anthony Young Weissman. Without that grab, Kay waltzes into the end zone. And this will force a field goal try.
Well, the blitz came. Jim Knowles dialed up another blitz. It was picked up pretty well, but that was great recovery by Young Weissman. And
boy,
literally a shoestring tackle.
Yes, it was. Miliano's already been good from 45. This will be from 27. High snap, they get it down, and Miliano knocks it through. So Duke stands tall inside the five. The penalty was a killer there.
At Belk, we're committed to supporting Southern communities and families. But together, we can do even more. There are cures to find and awareness to raise. Young minds to inspire in the classroom. Homes to build for neighbors in need. And hearts to mend. Together. So join us. At Belk, modern Southern style isn't just about fashion. It's a way of life and about giving back. To learn more, go to belk.com.
Let's see if we can get one past the defense.
Hut, go! Here it comes! Spray the numbers, boom! Get it, spin! Whoa. Oh, nice hands!
Jeff, oh, good job, man!
Nice!
Okay, halftime. Now this is my favorite play.
Oh!
I'm wide open. Oh, fumble. Don't want to fumble any of these.
Share what you love with who you love. Kellogg's Frosted Flakes.
Is up. And it's good.
Good! They're great!
Hurry and get to T-Mobile Zero Down Sale. Like snowflakes, it won't last long. Now through December 31st, our hottest 4G smartphones are zero down. Like Samsung's Galaxy S3, zero down. And the Windows Phone 8X by HTC, zero down. All with the only unlimited data plan on a nationwide 4G network. But hurry, when the year ends, so does zero down.
Division I student athletes have higher SAT and ACT scores than college-bound students.
The number of us receiving diplomas
is at an all-time high.
African-American males who are student athletes
are 10% more likely to graduate.
Still think we're just a bunch of dumb jocks?
You need to do your homework.
There are over 400,000 NCAA student athletes, and just about all of us will be going pro in something other than sports.
That's going to be a slugfest.
The championship game doesn't get more compelling than Notre Dame and Alabama.
It'll be some scene down in South Florida.
Visit WatchESPN.com or download the Watch ESPN app to watch ESPN live anytime, anywhere. Brought to you by Vizio.
Cincinnati has now scored 20 unanswered to take the lead over Duke. 20-16. Karune and Scott are deep.
And during the break, Brennan Kaye was getting some attention to his lower right back. They had a heat pad on that right hip. Of course, he was got a personal foul on the last one. His leg got caught up when the defender went over it. He was slow to get up, so wouldn't be surprised if that's the area they've been looking at, is was potentially injured on that hit.
They have a veteran quarterback ready to go, and Munchie Lego started the first eight. And they'll let this one hit and take over from the 25. Tonight, Belk presented a $1 million check to the Susan G. Komen Foundation for breast cancer research. That's part of a three-year effort to raise $3 million. Congratulations to them. It'll be interesting to now see how Duke responds after Cincinnati has just totally taken the momentum.
The run game was what got him going there in the first quarter. Things slowed down a little bit in the second quarter, so let's see if they're able to get that going again.
Both Thompson and Snead are in there right now. They fake it to him and throw to Thompson. Thompson across the 35 to about the 38 yard line for a first down. Bomar with another tackle. He's been very active tonight.
I've been impressed with all of the running backs from Duke and their acceleration after catching the ball. They all have good speed, but they seem to have a good feel, and not shockingly, in this offense. They've seemed to have a really good feel for the passing game.
Fake the run again, throw to Crowder. Crowder will pick up about seven. He's out to the Duke 47-yard line. Short passing game, very, very difficult to defend.
And if you have a guy in Renfrey who's on the mark, and for Cincinnati, you're going to kind of let those ones go. It's just make sure you're not letting something go over your head.
Snead tried to cut it to the outside, but the Bearcats defense was there. Got a really good mark. It looks like he's only going to be a half a yard shy of a first down as Arian Chenault made the tackle.
This is a, I always think of this third and a couple of inches as a chance to maybe take a shot.
Well, the last time they ran a third and short, it was from under center in a long developing play. This time they're going to throw for it, and Scott hesitated, then gets the first down as he dives across the 50. He almost made a mistake there and gave up the yardage that he needed.
He had a nice block on the edge there by Connor Vernon, the senior receiver, and Scott started doing that pitter-patter with his feet. I think all the Duke fans were saying, no, just fall forward, and you got the first. You don't have to hit the home run here.
First and 10, spotted just inside midfield. Renfrey fakes the screen, throws deep, intercepted. Picked off by Chenault. Chenault back to the 35, and there's a player down as well. A 22-yard interception return. And Cincinnati does the job on defense as they pick off Renfrey.
And Renfrey just makes a bad throw. The safety, Chenault, never, ever turned and ran. He was in perfect position.
Thank you.
at projectluna.com.
Gator I catch is a gator that doesn't die.
Gator Boys, Sundays at 9 starting January 6th, Channel 282, Animal Planet, surprisingly human.
Only five undefeated teams remain in college basketball, and at 12-0, the Cincinnati Bearcats are one of them. Their star guard has a message for you.
Hey everyone, this is Sean Kilpatrick from the A-Frank Cincinnati Bearcats. When you're done with our football team, please turn it to ESPN2 with us against New Mexico. Go Bearcats!
Usually, if we were saying Duke and Cincinnati, you would think basketball, but look at who the Bearcats are playing tonight, a really good New Mexico team. So we hope you'll go to ESPN2 to watch that. Maybe go back and forth between us and them.
We've got the Holiday Bowl tonight, too.
That's right. Cincinnati takes over after the interception. They'll start at the 40, and Kay is in there. They're going to run a reverse to McClung. McClung with room to run, knocked out of bounds. And we want to welcome in the new yet-to-take-over head coach of the Cincinnati Bearcats, Tommy Tuberville. Good to see you again, Tommy.
Good to see you, Mike. And I'm enjoying this game. I'm not up here very often. I'd rather be on the sideline, but what a heck of a game this is.
There have been so many stories about your departure from Texas Tech, so why don't you tell us exactly what happened, how you got from there to here?
Well, there's no easy way to leave. And
right.
Of course, and I left in a matter of 8 or 9 hour period. I had no thoughts of leaving Texas Tech. It's a great place, great people, but you know, this just seemed right fit, you know, for some reason, and my wife's from this area, so we're looking forward to it.
You know, coach, as this play turns into a big one for Cincinnati,
there goes Wynn. Touchdown. Well, you're good luck for the Bearcats,
well,
aren't
I'm
you?
I'm telling you, I need to stay up here.
46 yards for Wynn, who is having a huge game after a slow start.
And by the way, he's a senior.
Yeah, you know, that's, I tell everybody that, you know, bowl games, whoever can run the football is usually going to win. And Duke's thrown the ball pretty well, but they hadn't had the opportunity to run as much as Cincinnati tonight. And but it's been a good ball game. I've enjoyed watching it.
The Cincinnati program has lost three really good coaches in the last 10 years. It is a real juxtaposition to get somebody of your character and your record to come to Cincinnati.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. And again, you never know a situation. You hate to leave. And I've got a team to play in tomorrow night, Texas Tech. They're playing on ESPN tomorrow night, what, about 8:30 down in Houston. My son plays on the team, Tucker. And I hated it. You know, I hated breaking the news to the kids. But, you know, and it's a business. And, you know, I felt like in my career at my age, coming to Cincinnati was a great opportunity. And so I jumped on it. And hopefully it was the right thing to do.
You know, Coach, there's so much going on with conferences around the country.
Right.
And I was in Bristol when the news broke that you – and the word I used was confusing because, let's be honest, they're in the Big 12. Cincinnati, not sure where they're going to go. Most people watching this game are saying, why would a guy leave a place in the Big 12 to go to Cincinnati where there is an uncertain future in some regard?
You know, it's uncertain in all of college football. Heck, you know, in the Big 12 the last 3 years, we didn't know at Texas Tech where we were going to be. And fortunately, we landed in a great situation. That's going to be a great conference, and Tech's going to be, you know, is in a good spot. But, you know, the thing about Cincinnati is, you know, they're only one of four teams that's won, look like they're going to win 10 games 4 years in a row. Cincinnati's going to end up somewhere, and it's going to be in a good situation. But I didn't go there for that. I came because of the situation, the people, the opportunity to win games. You know, I'm over that point of, hey, you know, winning all the big games and being on television. But I tell you, Cincinnati's got a great program. I'm looking forward to being part of it.
Scott on the return, and he'll be swallowed up inside the 15-yard line. The ball came loose, but it was late. Ironically, one of the places that has been mentioned that Cincinnati could end up would be the Big 12.
Hey, I left Ole Miss and, of course, went to Auburn, and next year I had to go back to Oxford and play. That wasn't a fun time. How ironic that would be. But, you know, it's the business we're in. You know, I just love coaching. I love being around kids. We had great football kids at Texas Tech, and that was a tough situation, taking over from Mike Leach and the things that he had done. I was a totally different type of coach, and
sure,
and it wasn't a great fit at times, but I felt like we got the program back where you know, they're very competitive, and now that Cliff Kingsbury's a one of their own, and I think he'll do a great job there. So you know, it's probably good for all.
You know, that's what I was going to say, and I've known you for many years. It didn't quite seem like the fit at Texas Tech, and you worked hard because that team was getting better. You guys got better on defense this year. You finally got things settled, which is what your background is. But this feels like, for you, a personal decision, not as much a professional one. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's probably fair. But, you know, I go in and take over for a guy that throws for 500-600 a game, and I'm a defensive guy. And I was accepted by a lot of people there. And you know, again, our program was going in the right direction. The administration was great to me. But sometimes you think, and in your heart, you have to make a decision what's best for you, your family, and also for Texas Tech. And again, I think they're going to make a step forward with Cliff Kingsbury, and hopefully I did the right thing coming to Cincinnati. I know I made the right move. I'm just hopefully, you know, as we talked earlier about getting in the right conference to have that opportunity to play for championships.
There has been a commitment on the part of the university to improve Nippert Stadium, which is one of the oldest facilities in college football, and to build luxury boxes, which would be a huge step for the program.
Right. And we have to do that. You know, and Whit Babcock, our athletic director, and our president Ono, you know, there are two guys that are very adamant that, you know, in 2 years there's going to be major changes, and we're going to have to be somewhere, whether it's the Big East or somewhere else, depending on what happens. But you have to show the people that make the decisions that you're making those decisions to move forward in your program and to make it better. And we've done that with the stadium. We've got a great basketball program, and
yes,
Nick Cronin's done a great job. So, you know, I'm excited. I'm excited about the future, and looking forward to a challenge. They're all challenges. This is just a little different challenge than the one I had at Texas Tech and Auburn and Ole Miss.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Cincinnati, an injured player down on the field.
It looks like your quarterback is going to get an extra year applied to the NCAA because of injury issues. You'll lose some good guys off of this team, but you would have a starting quarterback come back. That's nice.
You know, he reminds me of Colin Klein. I've watched him practice a few times in the last few weeks, and he's got a good arm, but he's one of those guys that loves to run the football. So I'm excited. He's got a six-year back. We got most of our offensive line. We lose our running back, lose a couple of receivers. Defense, we're going to have to put it back together. The thing I've got in front of me now is to put together my entire coaching staff in the next week or so. That's a huge challenge. People don't realize putting together a coaching staff and how hard it is.
And that was what I was going to ask about your coaching staff. As you're putting that together and you start getting into the recruiting run, is it going to be Ohio-based because you can win a lot of games? Are you going to go back into some of the southern cities that you had success from, Auburn? What are you going to do recruiting-wise as well?
No matter where you're at, you've got to recruit 100 miles of your campus. Take an area. Most of your players have to come from that area. And we'll go to Georgia, we'll go to Alabama, we'll go to Florida, we'll go to a lot of places. But, you know, most of our players are going to come from the Midwest and from the Cincinnati area because there's great football, great high school coaching. And I'm looking forward to being part of, you know, that area and recruiting that area with all the great coaches and the great players.
Tommy, thank you so much.
Thank you, Mike.
Good to see you.
Yes, sir. Good to see you.
Wish you all the best at Cincinnati.
Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
You too.
Yes, sir.
You too.
Coach, thank you very much.
Thank you. And I said it was surprising we took the job, but I think you're right. I think Cincinnati and Texas Tech, both schools came out on top here. What a great hire to bring you in.
Absolutely. And good luck, Red Raiders, tomorrow night. I want to say that.
Okay.
I'm pulling for them.
All right. Tommy, thanks so much. We really appreciate it.
It's rare when you have a coaching change where you really can say that both schools got what they, you know, got something out of the deal that's going to work. For Cincinnati to be able to get Coach Tuberville, and honestly, it was shocking that you people around the country to do that was a major, major coup for this university.
Well, you're so used to Cincinnati going to smaller conferences to get whoever the hot coach in that conference is to bring them in, and they have picked so well. But to be able to get somebody of his stature,
and give Whit Babcock, the athletic director, who had been at Auburn as an assistant athletic director when Tuberville was there as the coach, give him credit for at least trying. He picked up that phone on that fateful Saturday morning for Cincinnati football and made a call that he didn't think was going to be received in any other way than, no, I'm happy here. But he called Tuberville, and Coach Tuberville said, well, let me talk to my wife. And his wife, of course, is from the area. And the deal was done over the phone. There was never an in-person interview. And I give Whit Babcock a lot of credit for being quick and hiring a guy that was not just a big splash, but a really good quality coach.
Well, he should get a lot of credit just for making the phone call.
Yeah, got to try.
Duke trying to answer that touchdown. Little swing out here to Duncan, who was dinged a couple of times in the first half and is back in the ballgame up near midfield. Duke would have to get to the Cincinnati 43.5 yard line for a first down. And David Cutcliffe, when we talked to him on the phone, it seems like a week ago now, said, I'm more for a go-for-it kind of guy once I get inside the 50.
Yeah, you get 6 or 7 yards here and don't pick up the first, there's no doubt that Duke will be going for it.
Renfrey in the pistol. Good protection. Floats it over the middle and caught inside the 15 by Scott. Somehow that ball got inside of three defenders, and Scott never broke stride and gains 39 yards.
And Drew Fry, the senior who comes up a little gimpy from the play, was in perfect position but just slightly misplayed this ball. Fry is there, and you could see the stumble as Fry was coming out of his break from the safety spot where he missed it.
Sneed to the 10. What a throw by Renfrey.
And what, you know, every play we've seen tonight, that's what's been fun about this game. It's not only good plays, but guys are in position. You cannot fault Drew Fry. He was in position. He had one step that stuck in the ground funny. But if he doesn't stumble, he makes a play on that ball, and it's most likely incomplete.
This will be the 11th play of this drive. Fake the draw. Renfrey for the end zone. Touchdown. The catch by Connor Vernon.
And these Duke players.
How many times have they done that?
Yeah, these Duke players have to be careful. They're turning and starting to chatter to the defense. They're going to be looking at a personal foul here if they're not careful.
Yeah, you don't want to be wolfing. And I'm surprised they didn't call that.
Yeah, Desmond Scott did it after his long catch, and that time it was Connor Vernon.
Well, maybe after all these years of no success, maybe you give them a long leash.
Yeah, and now down 5, you go for 2. I always think you go for 2 in the fourth quarter. I always think you're going to chase this if you don't make it, because it's under 50% that you convert these two-point conversions. I get it. You're on the number where you go for 2, but I always think you wait on these.
I like it because it tells you where you are one way or another.
But we'll see how it plays out then.
Under center this time is Renfrey. Rolls right, nobody there. Throw back wide open, 2 points. Blakeney. How do you like it now?
Well, and it's always great when it works, right?
Duke responds.
Wonderful play call. They left a receiver, Blakeney, open on the two-point conversion, but it was the senior all-time ACC leader in receivers, Connor Vernon, who had the touchdown.
Look, if you have COPD like me, you know it can be hard to breathe and how that feels. COPD includes chronic bronchitis and emphysema. Spiriva helps control my COPD symptoms by keeping my airways open for 24 hours. Plus, it reduces COPD flare-ups. Spiriva is the only once-daily inhaled COPD maintenance treatment that does both.
Spiriva Handihaler Tiotropium Bromide Inhalation Powder does not replace fast-acting inhalers for sudden symptoms. Tell your doctor if you have kidney problems, glaucoma, trouble urinating, or an enlarged prostate. These may worsen with Spiriva. Discuss all medicines you take, even eye drops. Stop taking Spiriva and seek immediate medical help if your breathing suddenly worsens, your throat or tongue swells, you get hives, vision changes or eye pain, or problems passing urine. Other side effects include dry mouth and constipation.
Nothing can reverse COPD. Spiriva helps me breathe better.
Ask your doctor about Spiriva.
Everybody, well, don't you know it's me now? Yeah, who's it? Who's it? Well, he's back with a brand new beat now.
This is Joe Wood's first day of work, and his new boss told him two things: cook what you love and save your money. Joe doesn't know it yet, but he'll work his way up from busser to waiter to chef before opening a restaurant specializing in fish and game from the great Northwest. He'll start investing early. He'll find some good people to help guide him, and he'll set money aside from his first day of work to his last, which isn't rocket science, it's just common sense. From TD Ameritrade.
ESPN College Football, the Belk Bowl, is brought to you by Belk, Modern, Southern, Style, and ProjectLuna.com.
Players from both teams had the chance to visit the NASCAR Hall of Fame, which is just up the street here in Charlotte from the Bank of America Stadium, which is the home of the Carolina Panthers. And Duke's right back in it at 27-24.
Now it comes down to, can Duke's defense start to hang in there a little bit? They've been giving up some big chunk yardage here in the second half, because this game's starting to feel like it might go back and forth.
Abernathy cut down at the 20. Let's check in with Janine Edwards.
Well, Mike and Ed, Duke basketball coach Mike Krzyzewski says this football program has not gotten where they are today without a lot of commitment, preparation, great vision and planning from head coach David Cutcliffe. And Mike Krzyzewski said the school also has made a tremendous investment in the football program. He said he is so proud of this team and for Duke University, especially tonight. He said it's about celebrating Duke. And so that's what the basketball team is doing. They practiced this afternoon, they gathered for a meal, and they are right now gathered as a group watching the Belk Bowl and rooting for their Blue Devil brothers.
Well, people forget when Mike Krzyzewski, Janine, took over that program, he had to build it up too. And he built it into a model for anyone to follow, and that's exactly what David Cutcliffe is trying to do with the football program.
How many groups of Blue Devils probably around the world are gathering to watch this bowl game? Because Janine made the report earlier about Coach Cutcliffe wearing the Duke football sweatshirt, and people saying, Duke football? And you heard his if you were with us at the pregame, as a Duke player down on the field.
Kyler Brown, a backup linebacker, is on the turf.
But the lengths that David Cutcliffe and his staff have gone to rebuild this program and get it to a place where you can start to see bowl games are going to be a regular thing. It looks to me like the way Cutcliffe has things going, this is going to be a regular occurrence.
Well, let's be honest about it. With as many bowls as there are right now, it's not that hard to get to a bowl.
No.
But Duke had not been to one since 1994.
Here's how you know how hard it is to coach at Duke in the ACC. go 6-6 and they make you the ACC coach of the year, because it is that Absolutely. Difficult that if you go 6-6 here, David Cutcliffe is the 2012 ACC coach of the year, because the other coaches around the league realize, and everybody who covers this league realize, it's tough to compete against teams like Clemson and Florida State week in and week out.
The other thing you got with David Cutcliffe is a guy who speaks his heart, and a guy who has been given the opportunity, at least to a lot of reports, to go back to Tennessee. In 2010 was the most interesting one. He said you have to follow your heart in big decisions. I have a lot of ties at Tennessee, a lot of people I'm very close to, and a lot of respect at the University of Tennessee. But my heart is here, meaning Duke. We've worked very hard these 2 years to change the culture. You feel like the job's not done. And in this era, it bothers me what we do as coaches, moving back and forth all the time. This quote came in mid-January when he was supposedly offered the job. He said, in mid-January, nothing about that felt right to me as a person. And boy, could you stand to hear that a few more times from a few more people.
And he had made the commitment to guys like Connor Vernon and this senior class and his quarterback, Sean Renfrey, that they were going to change the culture, and they have.
Kay, who was shaken up earlier and had some treatment on his back after he was tripped up near the goal line. That looked like motion early, no flag. And now Wynn on a little screen that they set up, and a terrific tackle by David Helton, who got out to the sideline to get that dangerous running back.
And now Sean Renfrey has to stand around and hope that his defense can get a stop or a turnover, which they haven't really been able to do here in the second half. And now it's starting to get a little cold out, so some of your receivers and running backs should probably stay. If Cincinnati's going to go on some long drives, you got to keep the lather.
Another huge third down here.
A quarterback draw would be something I'd think about the way Kay's been running.
Will Jim Knowles try another blitz? That's Abernathy in motion, and it is a quarterback draw. And Duke stayed home and stopped it.
I'm not so sure that this snap was not supposed to go to Abernathy. Yeah. It looked to me like they were going to try to do a direct snap, and you can see Kay right there kind of throw his hand down. Watch Abernathy right here.
That's why he stopped.
Yeah,
he was waiting for the ball.
And that's supposed to be a sweep to the outside, and Kay gets it, and I think he was a little confused because there may have been some running room there, but that looked like potentially a mistake by Dan Sprague not snapping a little earlier.
Yeah, that was another what do I do now?
Yeah.
Crowder is back. Big bounce, picks it up like Ozzie Smith on the hop, runs into his own man, flag is down, and so is Crowder at the 45. 15-yard return. Now we'll check the penalty. Yeah, pretty good pick by Crowder. Usually you have to have a glove to get it that well. And now they're indicating the markers against Duke.
And that was a pretty good tackle by Britton Greer. The only problem is he plays for Duke.
During the return, holding for 31 of the receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
Five games on Saturday across ESPN and ESPN2 on Capital One Bowl Week. The day kicks off with the Bell Helicopter Armed Forces Bowl, 11:45 on ESPN. Then the New Era Pinstripe Bowl at 3:15. Then on ESPN2 at 4, Kraft Fight Hunger Bowl. Then the Valero Alamo Bowl and the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl at 10:15. Capital One Bowl Week on Saturday.
There will be some dents in couches by about 12:30, 1 o'clock East Coast.
I have my spot reserved. Little swing to Crowder. Room to run.
Boy, I'd get him the ball as much as I could. He's exciting.
He's pretty good, isn't he? Let's check in with Reese Davis. Reese?
All right, Mike, I want to show you what's going on in ESPN2. Like the Duke men's basketball team, the Cincinnati men's basketball team's undefeated. They're playing New Mexico over on ESPN2. It's a 14-9 game about halfway through the first half there. Lobos under Steve Alford have lost only once.
Steve Alford's done a heck of a job out there, hasn't he?
Not shockingly.
No. That could easily be a flag, and it is, as Vernon was held by Cameron Cheatham. Now, Cheatham did everything he could. He grabbed out one arm and tried to disguise it.
And what is so hard when you're a cornerback is when a crafty receiver like Vernon.
Pass interference, defense number 21. 15-yard penalty to the previous spot.
And don't get me wrong.
First down.
You have to call this as pass interference. But if you're Cheatham, watch the left arm. Excuse me, the inside arm, the right arm of Vernon. See it right there? He's getting separation. And so, and remember, the official, the body is between. He can't really see that arm extended by two. So it's almost an impossible call to make. But it's just tough to blame a guy who's.
That is the old Michael Irvin. I'm getting open by 2 feet and drop the ball in here.
And the official has to be behind that play. So he's got the defender between him and the receiver. It's impossible to see.
And Connor Vernon just showed you the speed that most people didn't think he had. Here he's not going to be able to get away. And he's down to the 37-yard line, tackled again by Bomar. Connor Vernon, who has caught more passes for more yards than any other ACC receiver ever, 6 tonight.
Nobody tells stories about that punt on 4th and 1. Nobody relives that miraculous fair catch or taking a knee. And nobody remembers the guy who brought cheese and crackers.
Late night whipping it, we're magnificent. Yeah, I go hard in the fourth quarter.
6 crunchy tacos and 6 Doritos Locos tacos. Taco Bell's Variety Taco 12-pack. A game day tradition since right now.
There's an escaped fugitive coming through town.
You're looking jacked, Ray. You've been working out.
Give me the damn thing.
To save their town.
I got an idea.
This unlikely team is bringing out the big guns.
You never know.
Very nice.
The Last Stand.
Nice shooting, Sheriff.
Rated R in theaters January 18th.
Capital One Bowl Week continues Saturday. It's a top 25 matchup between Texas and Oregon State. Then two of the nation's stingiest defenses square off as TCU battles Michigan State. Capital One Bowl Week continues on ESPN. The Valero Alamo Bowl, Saturday at 6:45. Followed by the Buffalo Wild Wings Bowl at 10:15. College football lives here.
How are you guys gonna catch that gator, man?
By hand.
They risk their lives, saving the gators they love.
Every gator I catch is a gator that doesn't die.
Gator Boys, Sundays at 9 starting January 6th, Channel 282, Animal Planet, surprisingly human.
To say the least, the Belk Bowl has been a very entertaining game. Cincinnati leading Duke 27-24 as we start quarter number 4 from Charlotte. Duke facing second and long from the Cincinnati 37-yard line. Renfrey against the blitz. Got his backup quarterback, Brandon Kinnett, and Brandon Kinnett makes another catch and has a first down. That's four for him. They've used him as a tight end, a wide receiver, a wildcat quarterback, very versatile athlete.
Big guy, 6'2", 225 pounds. You can see right there, very natural catcher of the ball. So if he can do some things in space, why not get him out there a little more often? You get some bowl practice, start putting in a few more wrinkles potentially.
Snead is the single setback. They fake it to him. Renfrey under pressure, just going to throw it away.
Well, and they're looking to make sure that Renfrey was out of the pocket. The Cincinnati coaches want intentional grounding here.
Intentional grounding. The quarterback was outside the tackle box.
There you go.
It was close.
Yeah, and but I like that there was a clarification to make sure, because Steve Stripling was over there. Of course, he's a defensive line coach by trade. He's going to have to get, Renfrey's going to have to get right over. Well,
oh,
boy,
no.
He was not outside the tackle box.
No,
that should have been intentional grounding.
He was not. Big break for Duke. Those intentional grounding calls are huge. Vernon got another first down. Good block by Snead, the little guy out of the backfield. If you're going to run those tunnel screens, people have to block.
And there goes Snead. Boy, that was a not only a physical block, but he also finished the block, going one-on-one with Chris Williams. Not only did he get a shoulder in there, Josh Snead, but he stayed on his feet and ran through the block. That was tremendous effort.
He's 5'9", 170. That's pretty darn good. Renfrey gives it off to Thompson, trying to turn the corner, does, and gets inside the five. I get back to what we said in the first half. Duke's ability to run the football at times tonight has just been huge, and that's something they haven't shown all year long.
And they had it in the first quarter, and it looks like they're going to have it here in the fourth quarter. They got a stop on defense in a game that started to feel like a possession game, and they were behind because Cincinnati was up. Duke gets a defensive stop, and now Cincinnati not able to slow them down.
Renfrey has cracked the 3,000-yard barrier for the season, 293 tonight. Keeps it up the middle to the goal line. Going to be first and goal. Brandon Kinnett nearly got the touchdown. And they'll probably keep Kinnett in there because he has 7 rushing touchdowns on the year.
Yeah, I don't know why on first and goal you'd do anything else. If you have a wildcat package and a guy like Kinnett, continue to use it.
Cincinnati crowds the line. The ball was fumbled, and Kinnett is going to be stopped about the 1.5-yard line.
Now, low snap, and Kinnett was not able to get a hold of it.
Mills and Blair, the middle linebacker, combined on the stop. Of course, a lot of these Wildcat quarterbacks, you are limited. They're going to run the ball. That's it.
Well, and that's the thing. If you have a throw, here's where you call it.
Yep.
If you're going to have Kinnett in, you've got to throw out of this. This is where you've got to throw it. And Kinnett, a guy, he can throw it. You may not get as much productivity as you would with Renfrey, but I think this would be a situation where he may try.
He's only thrown the ball 12 times all year, 4 complete. 5 complete. Touchdown, David Reeves. Well, it's not going to get much easier than that, is it? And it's a great call because Cincinnati has to sell out on the road.
You have to. You absolutely have to. And the way Duke has been able to run the ball, and then they bring in Kinnett, who is their running quarterback, and they bring their tight end David Reeves in motion and slip him out, and it's very easy. Great call by the Duke offensive staff. And you can't blame Cincinnati because you're absolutely right.
They're just virtually impossible to cover. Duke regains the lead. The Blue Devils are up by 4 after Ross Martin's point after. He almost threw that ball too low.
he had the perfect pitch.
This lease gives us the right to drill on your land.
You could be a millionaire.
But he never expected a fight.
I work for a small environmental company.
Hey, get my friend a granola bar.
Did you have one of his eggs?
Oh, to beat you? Yeah.
Critics are raving. Promised Land is fantastically entertaining. Matt Damon has never been better.
We're a $9 billion company. Do you know what we're capable of?
Do you?
Oscar should take notice. It's one of the best pictures of the year from the director of Good Will Hunting.
What is going on here?
Steve!
Promised Land. Rated R.
He has inside jokes with complete strangers. Cuba imports cigars from him. Mosquitoes refuse to bite him, purely out of respect. He is the most interesting man in the world.
I don't always drink beer, but when I do, I prefer Dos Equis. Stay thirsty, my friends.
Join us at ProjectLuna.com.
Only Polaris delivers the ultimate combination of power, suspension, and agility. The only trail-capable side-by-sides featuring the ultimate value Razor 570. The only four-passenger sport machines led by the all-new Razor XP4. And the undisputed king of high-performance Razor XP. Razor sharp performance only from Polaris. Get huge rebates on 2012s and low financing on all models during the Polaris holiday sales event.
That's going to be a slugfest.
The championship game doesn't get more compelling than Notre Dame and Alabama.
It'll be some scene down in South Florida.
Capital One Bowl Week, available live anytime, anywhere on your computer, tablet, or smartphone at WatchESPN.com with the Watch ESPN app. Good ball game here.
If I were in charge of the kickoff team for Duke, I would have gotten on the headset to the head coach and said, remember that onside kick, the surprise onside kick we have? Why not? Give it a shot here. We've got some momentum. It's a bowl game. We're going for our seventh win of the season. If I were Cincinnati, I wouldn't be leaving the block until I knew that ball was over my head.
Abernathy with a running start at the 9. This kid is extremely quick. Then he gets drilled as he got to the 24-yard line by Deion Williams. Jamison Crowder's had quite a game tonight, and this follows a horrible accident that he was involved in this summer on a jet ski with another wide receiver, Blair Holiday. Holiday needed CPR from a nursing student to save his life at the scene. He had to be driven to a local hospital, then flown to another, had a traumatic brain injury, was non-responsive, and was not expected to live at the time. Somehow he pulled through, and the young man wants to go back to class in January, and eventually he wants to play football again. But if you're Crowder, you carry all that guilt with you, and it was just a horrific thing that happened to him. Cincinnati comes back in a big play down to the Duke 40. And Kelsey finally making an impact in the passing game for 35 yards. Can you imagine having that?
Yeah.
Even though it wasn't your fault, it was nobody's fault, it was just an accident. But to have a teammate lay dying near you, or what appeared to be, and then have to come back and focus.
And Holiday has made a miraculous recovery.
Hasn't he ever? Ball's bobbled. Now they'll run the flanker reverse, and it looks like they want to run a pass off of it. And instead, they won't get anything out of it, and Janine has more.
Well, guys, I spoke to Blair Holiday before this game, and interestingly, he told me that he's still great friends with Jamison Crowder, and they talk all the time, but not once have they talked about that accident. Blair said, I just didn't feel like I needed to talk about it. You know, he couldn't talk or walk for a month after that accident. He lost 40 pounds during his recovery. He doesn't know if he'll ever play football again, but he said the worst part for him was seeing how his injury impacted his family. His mom had to move here from California to take care of him.
Janine, that kind of a thing is something awful for people to go through. Ray. And off the hands. That could have been easily a huge play. Kembrell Tompkins ran under it, gave great effort, and then couldn't hold it.
And this is a play that T.J. Wiest, the interim offensive coordinator here for Cincinnati, has dialed up a couple of times, that long across the field throw. And Tompkins needs to make this catch. This is perfectly thrown, able to run through it, leaves his feet a little bit. Now, it wasn't the easiest catch in the world, but you got to be able to make that, because now you got third and long.
Third and long, Duke showing blitz, and Kay wants to check out of the play. Now Duke looks to the sideline. What do they want to do? Four-man rush. Kay throws high and incomplete the flag.
They're going to get Dwayne Norman, a true freshman, for pass interference. And I'm not so sure that Cincinnati wouldn't have gone for it on fourth down.
Pass interference. Oh, defense number 40. 15-yard penalty to the previous spot. Automatic first down.
So you can't say that the penalty. Yeah, you can't say that the penalty, because they maybe would have had another chance, but I'm not sure you call that. I don't think that that ball is catchable by Wilt Chamberlain. So I just don't think that you, I think you have to call uncatchable. Now, that's not to say Cincinnati doesn't go for it on fourth and pick up first, but I don't think that that was pass interference. I think that ball was uncatchable.
Well, I think the ball was already gone by the time there was contact, too, so it can't be. Big break for the Bearcats. Let's see if they can convert. Ray to the end zone. Did he hold it? He did. Touchdown. Chris Moore. Only his fourth catch all year. And it's a touchdown to put his team back in front in the ballgame. Boy, Kay has made some great throws. Tony Foster was right there, but I don't think he ever saw the ball.
If I'm Tommy Tuberville, I'm awfully glad that Kay's got a six-year of eligibility. Lost it more than 2 years to injury. That's the watermark if you get a six-year. But if I were Tommy Tuberville, the new coach for Cincinnati, I'd be smiling right now.
Well, I think that's one position he does not have to worry about next year. 77 yards in a minute and 26. Duke will serve when we come back.
The boys use Capital One Venture Miles for their annual football trip. That's double miles you can actually use. Tragically, their buddy got sacked by blackouts.
But it's our tradition.
That's roughing the card holder.
But with the Capital One Venture card, you get double miles you can actually use. Any fright? Any time.
Scoreboard doesn't lie.
What's in your wallet? I have me on my fantasy team.
Why do I like this new Buick Verano? It lets me audible.
OnStar, how can I help you?
Orange barrel, reroute.
Sending new route now.
My friend. Call Papa Bear. Hut, hut.
Hey, Peyton, just fired up the grill.
Tune XM60 Outlaw. If you don't know the innovative Verano, then you don't know Buick.
Don't wait for the new year to experience Buick. Lease this innovative Buick Verano with 2 years of scheduled maintenance for around $199 per month.
5 RPM gum, a relaxing mint flavor. Senses.
Mine was earned off Vietnam in 1968.
Over the South Pacific in 1943.
I got mine in Iraq, 2003.
USAA Auto Insurance is often handed down from generation to generation because it offers a superior level of protection, and because USAA's commitment to serve the military, veterans, and their families is without equal. Begin your legacy. Get an auto insurance quote. USAA. We know what it means to serve.
Sorry, I couldn't get away.
You can't now.
Chris Davis with you on ESPN2 New Mexico and Cincinnati. Jaquan Parker of the Bearcats, the only bucket he's made so far. He got the and one. Undefeated Cincinnati up 23-22. That's on ESPN2. Bridgepoint Education Holiday Bowl coming up. Brett Hundley's had a great year for UCLA. They take on Baylor. They're going to kick off 1 minute before the top of the hour. And if we're not done in Charlotte, we'll start that game on ESPN News and then get you out to San Diego as soon as we can, Mike.
All right, Reese, and we certainly have many ways to get it to
you. Yeah, and I'll tell you what, stay up for Baylor, UCLA.
Up a long time.
Yeah, if you have not seen Baylor play offense, and look out for Jonathan Franklin of UCLA. That guy is an every down NFL back, over 1,700 yards. What an excellent job Jim Moore Jr. and his staff did this year at UCLA.
Hasn't he, though? Well, this game has been just about as much fun as we could have possibly hoped for. Back and forth and back and forth. Cincinnati now up 34-31, 11-19 to go in the game. Scott a yard deep. Stop shy of the 20.
Well, this has become a game of almost who's going to have the ball last between the two quarterbacks. Remember that 3rd and 8 down inside their own 2-yard line. Kay takes off, picks up a huge first down. And then you made the point a minute ago. He has made some terrific throws. It's the run game that has gotten this offense going by Brendan Kay, but he has been on point with those long throws. The other thing I've noticed too, both these quarterbacks have done a great job of throwing the ball on time or even a touch early, because the coverage has not been bad by either team tonight. It's just been pretty good quarterback play.
I agree. Renfrey. Another short set and gets it out to his favorite target, Connor Furman. That's 8 catches for the senior from Miami, who was only 5'8", 165 as a 16-year-old. Was not recruited virtually at all. If you're 5'8", 165, nobody wants to sign you to a D1 scholarship. But he had his growth spurt before his senior year, and then people started coming around.
Well, I think the NFL scouts have already found him, and I think this guy's going to move up the board when people start studying him.
He will play on Sunday. Jalay Duncan makes the catch. And we are told now that the Holiday Bowl will start at 9:59 Eastern on ESPN News. So if you're waiting for that game, that's where you'll be able to find it.
I'd say you may want to stick around for this one. No, I think it's going to be a pretty good
finish. Well, we hope so. Yeah. And that game's going to last 4 hours.
Yeah, you're going to have time.
Of course, I think this one is going to last 4 hours. Both quarterbacks have just been terrific. Duncan bowls his way across the 40.
I think that Duke
runs hard.
I think Duke is going to find a running game next year with this young man, Duncan. All of their backs have run really hard, but Duncan unfortunately had that fumble down on the goal line. You know, and that'll happen.
Huge
bowl
play.
Game. Yeah, it was a huge play, but boy, this guy runs hard. He's got good vision, good cuts.
2nd and 2. Duncan stays in the ball game. Blakeney in motion. Duncan again picking his way, and he's got the first down up at the 46-yard line.
Of course, Duncan was after that hit by Blair, which was helmet to helmet that caused the fumble, was taken out and had to be checked out during halftime. So obviously passed all the tests to come back in.
That's Snead on the sideline. He has been their speed back tonight. Blitz.
They throw to Duncan out of the backfield up near midfield, taken down by Cheatham.
You know, we were talking to David Cutcliffe about, there was a story about how Peyton Manning, when he was rehabbing and trying to figure out how he was going to, if he was going to even come back from neck surgery, he went and worked during the offseason with his old quarterback coach from Tennessee, David Cutcliffe. And, you know, when we talked to Sean Renfrey about what Coach Cutcliffe was like, was that after that, those workouts, he said he was more intense and way more hands-on.
Blakeney taken down at the 40. I mean, if you're David Cutcliffe and a high school quarterback doesn't know about your history and asks you, well, who were the best two quarterbacks you ever coached? They say, well, you may have heard of Peyton and Eli Manning.
And he also coached T. Martin, who won a national championship at Tennessee the year after Peyton left. But that offseason workout, I think it's clear that it energized David Cutcliffe and got him back to his roots as a coach, because Sean Renfrey said he was way more hands-on this camp than he has been the previous 3 years.
Blitz coming. Renfrey floats it. Incomplete, intended for Crawford. There was some contact with Drain, but Crawford did not complain after the play, or Crowder. Normally you'll see a guy throwing his arms.
I don't think that that was interference, but I am a little surprised. Most receivers look like they're theatrical majors. Yeah,
that's right. If somebody's within 5 yards, they're complaining, and that was perfect coverage. Fake the blitz again. Now Snead on the draw. And Snead will get to the 35. It'll bring up third to about 4.5. Good tackle by Chris Williams.
And now this game's literally going to come down to who has it last, because I think these defenses, you know, with when you start having 2, 3, 4, 5, and when you get to the national championship game that much time off, it is hard to be as conditioned as you are during the season. And I think these defenses are starting to get pretty worn out.
Could be four down territory here. Blitz coming. Renfrey unloads. Incomplete. From here, it would be a 52-53-yard field goal attempt. Dominique Battle caught up to that, and that pass was thrown late.
It was late, and he floated it as well, because Blakeney gets away with a little bit of a push-off there. Great recovery by Battle, but this ball was thrown a little bit late and a little bit soft. But now, it looks like they're going to let the freshman try the long one.
Well, he made a 53-yarder, made in quotes, because there was a penalty on the play, took off the board. He missed a 49-yarder. This will be from 52. And he got it. Boy, this kid is money in the bank. We are tied at 34. A chance to check in with Reese Davis.
All right, Mike, Nick Florence leads the nation in total offense. We've seen a couple of great quarterbacks going at it in the Belk Bowl, and guys who can put up big numbers coming up. Brett Hundley against Nick Florence, UCLA and Baylor. Kickoff 1 minute before the top of the hour. We'll start it on ESPN News. Get you back to Charlotte right after the break.
The Tostitos Fiesta Bowl, Oregon, Kansas State, January 3rd on ESPN.
Driving would be so much easier if trouble would just tell you it was there. But it doesn't. So we put advanced safety features like a rear view camera with available rear cross traffic alert and side blind zone alert into the new Buick Enclave. Just one more way, the new Enclave is smart, made beautiful.
I'm a mama's boy. Punch brings my family together. I usually talk longer with my mother. My bill is always flat, it's always the same. No extra cost, no limits on the time, so it just works very good. Everybody has a favorite in their family, and I'm pretty sure I'm the one for my mom, so. Mi nombre es Raul Santoyo. And my mom is why I switched to Vonage.
Get unlimited calling to Mexico and over 60 countries for one low price from any phone.
Last chance for DirecTV Cinema's holiday offer.
This is the American fantasy right here.
Get $10 back when you order any 4 movies this month, like Total Recall.
Just tell me what's going on.
Your memory was replaced.
10.
Down here, not looking up your towel, swear to God.
The Dark Knight Rises.
Save yourself.
And Ice Age Continental Drift.
Let's move!
Order any four movies this December and get $10 back. DirecTV Cinema, starting at channel 125.
Now playing on DirecTV Cinema. Everyone's talking about...
Brady Lynn, Heavenland,
Tammy Lynn.
One of the funniest movies...
Cousin Buddies for Life, right, Johnny?
Right.
...of all time.
You're just like the baby Jesus.
Ted is truly brilliant.
My bad, I was sending a tweet.
Who are these girls?
Laurie, hey, you're home early.
And now you can catch the unrated version you couldn't see in theaters.
Okay, all right, so that's where we'll draw the line.
Ted, now playing on DirecTV Cinema. Movie start at channel 125.
ESPN College Football, the Belk Bowl, is brought to you by Belk, modern, southern, style. And a venture card from Capital One. Earn double miles you can actually use.
Charlotte is now the home of the U.S. Airways Flight 1549, better known as Miracle on the Hudson. The actual aircraft, the Chesley Sullenberger, landed on the Hudson River back in January of 2009, part of the exhibit at the Carolina Aviation Museum. Normally, planes that crash don't look that good.
No.
What a miracle that was, though. Tie ball game, 7:24 to go. Abernathy is deep, and this kick over his head.
Well, you were talking about the field goals at the end of the half when Duke lined up for a 53-yarder that was good by Ross Martin. You could hear the whistles for illegal substitution against Cincinnati. They move it up 5 yards, and then from 49, Martin misses by, I don't know, a foot or two.
Yeah.
And then he gets another shot at 52, and you're right, this guy is money. Bounces right back from that miss at the end of the half. And that kick barely gets over it. I don't know if he was 53 there, I'm not sure that would have made it, but doesn't matter. Still gets the ball record for longest field goal. Nice job.
Now it's up to Brendan Kay again, who has been equal to the task all night long on the keeper. Trying to get to the outside, and Duke won't let him. They'll take him down after a gain of 2 or 3. Good stop by Anthony Young-Wiseman. Here's Janine.
Well, guys, and that's the thing that Duke's going to need to keep doing is making stops. That's what the defensive coaches have been imploring their players right now, because defense has been their Achilles heel all season. The coaches are saying, guys, it's not Cincinnati beating us right now. We're beating ourselves. And several times the coaches have reminded them they're not using their hands well. So keep an eye on that.
Kay throws underneath to his big tight end, Kelsey. Going to be a couple of yards short. Kelsey came in as not only the leading receiver in terms of catches, but in terms of yards. And it's highly unusual, and touchdowns. One of only three tight ends in the entire country that leads in all three of those categories, and yet we've only called his name a couple of times tonight. Well, mostly he's been a blocker.
And that's the thing, and that's why this guy projects so well into the next level. Not only is he good catching the ball, but he is can be a dominant blocker. You've seen him move a lot in different positions.
Third down after third down, Cincinnati has been able to convert and keep the drive alive. Now it's third and two. Win. No, didn't even get back to the line of scrimmage. So Cincinnati went with a strength, their running game, and win against Duke's weakness, the ability to stop the run, and it blew up in their face. And there is Jim Knowles, the defensive coordinator, celebrating.
Well, and what Jim Knowles did was he took Jamal Bruce and Justin Fox and lined them both up on the inside shoulders of the guards. So he defended what are called the A-gaps on either side of the center with two defensive tackles. It was the perfect alignment against an inside run play.
Now O'Donnell to kick to Crowder, who takes it on the hop and makes the first man miss. Crowder! In the open field, taken down at the 42-yard line, and that was a saving tackle by Nick Temple. As it was, he gained 19 yards on the return after a 44-yard kick, and Duke with great field position in a tie ball game.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire.
Jack Frost nipping at your nose.
Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight.
Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas to you. Merry Christmas, everybody.
It's a 315 horsepower, 5.3 liter V8 Nutcracker. The 2013 GMC Sierra. Get 0% financing for 60 months, plus trade up to this specially equipped Sierra and use your $2,000 package discount for a total value of $4,000. Or choose to trade up with customer cash and your $2,000 package discount for a total value of $7,500.
Nobody tells stories about that punt on 4th and 1. Nobody relives that miraculous fair catch or taking a knee. And nobody remembers the guy who brought cheese and crackers.
Late night whipping it, we're magnificent. Yeah, I go hard in the fourth quarter.
6 crunchy tacos and 6 Doritos Locos tacos. Taco Bell's Variety Taco 12-pack. A game day tradition since right now.
Rich, chewy caramel, rolled up in smooth milk chocolate.
Don't forget about that payroll meeting.
Rolo, get your smooth on, also in minis. Join us at ProjectLuna.com.
Reese Davis with you in San Diego, just about set to kick off. Baylor and UCLA at Qualcomm Stadium. That's going to start on ESPN News. As soon as we get this great finish done in Charlotte between Cincinnati and Duke, we'll get you out for the Bruins and the Bears. And by the way, Bearcat fans locked in on this football game. Your basketball team's up 26-22 on New Mexico. They are at halftime on ESPN2.
Reese, that's important too, for sure. Duke takes over at its own 43-yard line. 5:17 to go. This could well be Duke's last possession. Snead got to the corner. Boy, how did he pick up 12 yards on that run? It looked first like he was only going to get 2, then maybe 5. He ends up getting 12.
Well, you know, when we were talking to David Cutcliffe about his team, and they were talking about the improvements they've started to make on the offensive line, they know they need to make some improvement on defense, but you could tell he's very happy with the skill players that they've been recruiting here. And you're starting to see guys like Jameson and Snead and Duncan. These are ball players.
Tunnel screen, Vernon. And he is smashed after a gain of 10, just crushed by Drew Fry. That may have been helmet to helmet as well. 9 catches, 106 yards.
Let's watch right here at the end.
Oh,
well,
sure was.
You know, and that one's hard because the face mask was actually what made the first contact. So that's not targeting, because the face mask hit. He didn't duck his head. He didn't leave his feet. So that's a good no call there.
Snead again. What a great cut he made right after he got the football. A very little subtle move to the left that got him past the first tackle.
You know, it's a little bit of a misdirection, and you're going to see Snead get right up behind David Reeves, and that's what he's cutting back. But it was the balance. He almost lost his feet as he ran up on the feet, the heels of his offensive line. But that was a nice job by Snead to keep his balance. He runs bigger than 170 pounds.
Yes,
doesn't he
does. Runs a lot of heart. You already saw him as a blocker. Snead again diving forward. He'll be about a half yard short of a first down. Well, not many of you were probably around January 1st, 1961. That's the last time Duke won a bowl game, the Cotton Bowl. Back in the day, Duke had a big-time football program, and the Cotton Bowl was a big-time New Year's Day bowl. They beat Arkansas, another big-time program, 7-6. David Cutcliffe trying to do it for the first time since 1961.
The keeper will give them a first down to the 24.
And have you noticed something about this drive? How much they're running the ball. I think David Cutcliffe is saying, we got the ball back with 5:17 left, and you said this might be Duke's last possession. I think he's saying, we've been able to run the ball. Why not make this the last possession of the game? Now, they're not going to be able to run out this clock and score, I don't think, necessarily, but you don't expect Duke, who came in somewhere in the hundreds of rushing
104.
Offense, 104 in the country of rushing offense, to be able to eat up 5:17, but they may just do it.
Well, they're not 104 tonight. Snead again.
Boy, he runs hard.
Doesn't he?
Yeah. And give
and
Cincinnati.
Every run, this is 40
yeah.
seconds of play.
I know. Yeah, and Cincinnati, I think, at some point, need to start thinking about timeouts, because Duke, if I'm Duke, if they're not going to call timeouts, I'm going to eat as much clock as possible.
Absolutely.
And maybe even think about, if we end up with a field goal, but we eat all the clock, why not? Yeah,
you got a field goal that's missed three times
all year yeah.
long, and the only one he missed in this game was by a foot from 48 yards. Play action fake. Caught for a first down by Connor Vernon. Again, that's a play where Cincinnati has got to be thinking run. You use the play action to get your best receiver open.
Watch how fast Vernon gets out of this break. Renfrey throws this right away. He's so smooth. He's so good out of his break. And Cheatham, who's one-on-one coverage, he can't let him get over the top of him, so he's got to start bailing. But that's two guys who have thrown a lot of – they've thrown and caught a lot of balls between the two of them.
You wouldn't want to bet against two or three runs here, would you?
No, not at all.
First and goal with a minute 49 left to go in the game. Snead is the running back. Snead gets the ball. And now if you're Cincinnati, you've got to start working on those timeouts. Otherwise, you're not going to have any time left.
And that's exactly what Stripling's going to do. I was just going to say, you know, what we've been talking, of course, there's going to be a turnover in the coaching staff. Butch Jones already gone to Tennessee as the head coach. Steve Stripling will join him, but serving as interim. But because of this small staff, I was wondering, who's their clock guy? Because every staff has a guy who knows the clock and can make suggestions strategy-wise, but this was a good timeout by Cincinnati.
They're all doing double or triple duty, and sometimes things are going to fall through the cracks, and it's not their fault.
No, but that was a good use of timeout there.
Capital One Bowl Week continues tomorrow. Three more games at 2 o'clock. It's Ohio against Louisiana Monroe in the AdvoCare V100 Independence Bowl. Then at 5:30, Rutgers, Virginia Tech in the Russell Athletic Bowl. And at 9, Minnesota and Texas Tech square off in the Meineke Car Care Bowl of Texas. Capital One Bowl Week tomorrow on ESPN, also live on Watch ESPN. Well, if Cincinnati is going to use a timeout after second down and a timeout after third down, presuming no score, then Duke is only going to be able to work it down to around 110 and maybe kick a field goal. 110's a lot of time.
It is.
For Cincinnati.
And your goal if you're Duke is obviously you want to get 7. Now you go into the Wildcat, which they've shown they can throw, but if you could get this under a minute with a score and use the timeouts, it's a perfect scenario.
Kinnett gives it to Snead. The ball come out. Oh, man. I haven't seen a signal yet. Cincinnati's saying they have it. No signal. And Cincinnati has the ball. Brandon Mills came in to make a hit on Snead. The ball came loose, and for the second time, Duke has turned it over inside the 10-yard line. It looked like John Williams, number 95, made the recovery.
Well, that's not much of a hit by Mills, but I will say this. That's two freshman running backs who have fumbled inside the 10-yard line for Duke. And I don't want to take anything away from Cincinnati. They've hung in this game early on. It looked like they might get run out of this building. Now they've got a chance. They've managed the clock well. Their quarterback's played well. But for Duke, talk about missed opportunities. You fumble the ball twice inside the 10-yard line. That's tough to swallow.
We could be talking about two more touchdowns, and that would have them at 48. Now, what do you do when you're Cincinnati? Ray under pressure. Makes two guys miss, fighting for extra yards. Very close for a first down for Brandon Ray. Brandon Kay, excuse me.
And Kay has just been a monster running the ball tonight.
He's been great.
Yeah. And here's the other beauty for Cincinnati. Of course, Steve just needs to keep his head up. You can't get lost here. You may end up, you never know, you may end up getting the ball back and you got to go back in. You got to stay focused.
His teammates trying to encourage him.
But for Cincinnati, what a huge break that they didn't use another timeout before that fumble. Yes. So now they have two timeouts. And with the clock stopping out of bounds and the chain moving, this is a lot of time.
Kay, a very, very dangerous pass intended for Kenbrell Tompkins. He threw that ball from near the far hash to the near side. That's a long, long way in the air.
Took a long time to get there, and the ball just floated on him. You could see the receiver, Tompkins, waiting, and have to make an adjustment.
Now you've got third and a yard.
Well, I still think you throw it here because you're going to go for it in four downs because I don't think, well, I just worry about you run it and how much clock you're going to run because you're starting to run against the clock in this field position at a minute, 6 seconds.
If they don't get it, I have to kick it out of here. Win.
Well, you'd have to go for it because Duke can run out the clock even with two timeouts. And it's a Bearcat. Excuse me. You kick the ball, tie ball game. But my problem there is now you're giving the ball on the 50-yard line.
Oh, sure.
You know?
Kelsey! The big tight end with the game's biggest play, 83 yards. Well, they waited long enough to use their biggest weapon, didn't they?
Now the problem is, did they score too soon?
Never score
yes,
too soon.
That's a fair point.
Kelsey, 6'6", 260. Did you see the speed on that young man?
Yeah, you can.
He is going to be playing a long time on the next level. And Kay with a perfect pass. 41-34. What a turnaround. Duke goes from getting the go-ahead touchdown, fumbling at the five, and Cincinnati makes them pay. Boy, oh boy. Longest touchdown in Belk Bowl history. Boy, if you're the quarterback, you're just thinking, I got him.
Yeah, and the safety had moved over to the middle of the field. Young Weissman, because there was a route going off to his left, he slid over just enough. Walt Canty, the safety who had walked over to cover, let the Kelsey go like you're supposed to in that coverage, and Kay made a wonderful read, and unfortunately for Duke, the fumble, the second fumble inside the 10, maybe the one that cost him. But I still wonder, 44 seconds.
Yeah.
You're right. You can never score too soon.
Well, if you're a safety and you take the wrong angle, and he obviously did, it could be an 83-yard touchdown.
And you think how crazy this is. And I know I'm talking about whether Cincinnati would have gone for it on fourth and one inside their 15. But if you punt the ball at that point, Duke's going to have the ball at the 45, and you only need about 15 or 20 yards for a field goal. So I know it sounded crazy at the time, but I think in a bowl game, you'd have to consider, we punt this away, and we probably lose the game.
Well, they probably would think of that, that's for sure. Little squid kick. And Duke will have it first and 10 at the 32. We check in with Reese.
Guys, we'll let you know they've started Baylor and UCLA. It's on ESPN News, and if you happen to have ESPN 3D, it's also being shown on ESPN 3D right now as Glasgow Martin IV just picked up a first down for the Bears. Scoreless, just over 6 minutes in. We'll get you to San Diego as soon as we're done in Charlotte.
Thank you, Reese. You have a 3D TV? I got to come up with some spare change somewhere and get one of those. Big task in front of Duke right now. Four-man rush. Complete pass to Crowder at the 45. It's going to be a first down. They'll stop the clock momentarily at 32 seconds.
And really smart here by David Cutcliffe. You have three timeouts. And because you need a touchdown, every second's going to count. Even though the clock stops, once the officials set the ball,
it starts.
And especially because it's not a long game, so it's not going to take long. That was a really smart timeout because at 32 seconds with three timeouts, it's about extending the game as long as possible. And that would have cost them probably 7 or 8 seconds had they not used that timeout.
They did a study in the NFL quite a while back that said a pass over 20 yards downfield will take about 13 seconds for everybody to get down there and for you to clock it. So if you're going to hit it, to have those timeouts in your back pocket.
Huge.
Player of the game, our Capital One player of the game, Brendan Kay. 332 yards passing, some critical runs. Almost caught, almost intercepted. The pass was behind Scott, off of his hands, and Fry nearly had it. There's a marker down back near where the pass was thrown.
I think this is going to be a
personal foul.
Huge
roughing the passer. 99 defense, blow to the head. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
Dan Giordano, a senior, with
15 yards.
Yeah, and you think about, you know, the left hand right into the face mask. And here's the thing, that 15 yards is gained by Duke with no time off the clock.
Exactly.
Because the clock is melting away, that 15 yards with no time running off, not just the 15 yards, but no time runoff is huge.
Duke about at the point where they can get Hail Marys out of this. Renfrey hit the ball, is intercepted. Picked off by Nick Temple. And Nick Temple is going to score for Cincinnati. Malik Beaumar, who has made one big play after another tonight, got the hit on Renfrey, and he really drilled him. The ball popped loose, and it's a touchdown.
Well, and unfortunately for Duke and Renfrey, he's still down. That was a big, clean hit by Malik Beaumar, who came completely unblocked. And unfortunately for Sean Renfrey, his last play for Duke may be a tough one. That's just a tough way for a young man to go out.
Yeah, he was drilled.
But give credit to Steve Stripling and this pared-down defensive staff for Cincinnati. They brought a timely blitz. Beaumar came on the side away from the running back. And Renfrey, unfortunately, never saw Beaumar coming. You can see the back lined up to his left. And here's from the outside is Beaumar's going to come. There is nobody to that side to pick him up because Beaumar was lined up on a receiver. Renfrey had no clue he was coming. The ball pops up in the air, and fortunately for Cincinnati, falls into Nick Temple's arms. But that was a wonderful call by the Cincinnati defensive staff.
Yes, it was. Desperate times require desperate measures.
And give Beaumar credit. Because he was lined up in the slot, he never showed that he was blitzing. Because if you see that, Renfrey could have switched the protection, put the back to the other side to pick him up, but he was able to disguise it the entire time.
Duke had given up 49.5 points a game in its last four games. Right now they have given up 48 to Cincinnati, but they played a lot better than that would indicate.
That was just excellent timing by Beaumont. It looked like, if you looked at that 100 times on film, it would look like number four was going to go and cover Crowder. He never moved his feet before the snap. And that's why Renfrey, a veteran quarterback, coached by one of the best quarterback coaches in the history of the game, and David Cutcliffe, Cincinnati bluffed him. And that was just wonderful call, wonderful execution by Beaumont, because you've got to assume a senior quarterback being coached by a guy like David Cutcliffe would be able to see it coming, not the way that Cincinnati ran. That was just a terrific blitz.
Beautifully designed.
And executed.
Nick Temple playing that linebacker spot in place of Walter Stewart, the All-American linebacker who suffered a cervical spine injury earlier this season and was lost. He would have been a first-round draft choice had he remained healthy, but Nick Temple getting the opportunity to play, and he made the most of it there.
And for Cincinnati, unless Duke can come out, there's just nothing they can do. No. To turn this around. So for Cincinnati, they're going to get their 10th win for the fifth time in 6 years. And you line up the schools who've done that: Alabama, Oregon, Virginia Tech, and Oklahoma.
Pretty good company.
Yeah.
Squib kick again. 9 seconds to go in the game. Here's Reese.
All right, Mike, Bridgepoint Education Holiday Bowl. Baylor has struck first. Glasgow Martin the fourth, going 1 yard for every number at the end of his name. 4-yard touchdown. Baylor up on UCLA 7-0. Get you there in a few seconds.
Boy, Reese, Baylor doesn't take much time to score, do they? Give us the ball. We have had 1,090 total yards in this game. It has been an offensive explosion.
Yeah, and unfortunately for Sean Renfrey, he's not going to be able to take the last snap for Duke. But here's a young man who's had a fine career and should take nothing away but pride from what he and all of his teammates and this staff and everybody at Duke has done to get this thing headed in the direction where they're going to start having some winning seasons around here in football.
That is for sure. I think there's 1 second left on the clock. And because it was a first down, they will mark the first down and then wind the clock. And this game will be over with Cincinnati. The winner here in the Belk Bowl. Once again, the final score, 48-34 Cincinnati. Now we send you to San Diego for Baylor and UCLA in the Bridgeport Education Holiday Bowl. Standing by with a call, our buddy Dave Patch. Dave?